lonesome little vine coming up, you know? It just didn't even occur to me that it would be poison ivy. It's a fun flower bed in our house. There's no other ivy. It's poison ivy around here.
That's right.
Hey, Tom.
How you doing?
I was just asking Teresa. I got my first phone call from somebody interested in, and I was going to email you and ask you, and then I just asked Teresa if she wanted to look to be sure. A lady lived in Hunter Ridge, no covenants, and she wanted to be able to have two chickens.
Chicken pets?
No, she wants them to have eggs.
Okay, yeah, I have to check. Teresa got checked on for you.
She went back in there.
Okay.
But I was.
Oh, that's right.
Okay. Check out. I wasn't off the top of my head, but I can check out. I'll let you know.
I knew. I thought something might have changed with that when the bee ordinance thing came up and what was domestic and what was okay.
Yeah. Get your story out. I had to figure out first what there's Hunter Ridge. Is that
yeah, it's Hunter Ridge. It, what was it back then? R1R or something?
Yes.
That's a long time ago.
I bet it's R2R.
R2R.
R2R. Chickens have your eggs out there.
Yeah, but you would have been in zoning back then, Carla. That's how far back it goes.
Yeah.
So you're trying to find out if she's allowed to have them.
Yeah, I was supposed to find. I need to find out for. I think as people want to process their own food now and have their own. You know, there's small gardens and they want to have their own chickens and stuff. It's going to be a question that's going to come up more often.
So that's just like you let dog, you start out with two.
Absolutely.
Who's watching? You got five.
I asked Patricia if she can give a direct answer this year.
Maybe. Maybe. I was out of town till way late. My truck was broken down to go get it. See ya.
Good afternoon.
Yes, indeed.
Oh, good. How about you?
You're sitting in the
five. Jeff came today.
What's rainy day?
Big crowd. I guess I'll be back to home.
You're wrong, brother.
Yeah, I think you got a lot of interesting stuff going on.
How you doing? You good?
Take your safety.
Yes. Hello, Ryan.
Hi, Tim.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
You all right?
Doing good. How are you?
Good.
Hi, over here in the corner.
Oh, all right.
Help yourself.
I'll see how long it'll be.
Thank you for that. So sometimes
they, and that's, I felt the same way. So I said,
Okay, I would like to call the Forsyth County Board of Commissioners Tuesday, August 28th, 2 p.m. meeting to order at 2:07 p.m. If you'll rise for the invocation pledge. Dear Heavenly Father, please look down with your guidance and protective hand on all of us. Protect everyone from the storm that at least appears on the news to be raging in parts of the country. Protect us from outside enemies and help us to see wisdom and the right thing for the citizens of this county. And please especially protect those who put themselves in harm's way for us, both here in this country and internationally. In my own name we pray.
Amen. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I should have said, Commissioner Pan, it's not here, all the commissioners are present. Actually, he just walked into the room, so all commissioners are now present. Here's the thing. Are there any changes to the agenda?
What is this? Hey, George.
Thank you. Any changes? Changes, Patrick? Counselor?
Mr. Chairman, I have a few.
A few.
Mr. Chairman, first of all, I would like to add, if the board will authorize it, a new item at the very end of the agenda. This would be agenda item 28, and this would be a an agreement between Forsyth County and, I'm not sure I got the party correctly identified, Carolan Properties as receiver for Eastbrook Properties. This would be an extension of their payment of their fine reduction award. This is something the board has already approved, but they were asking for an additional 2 weeks. So it's a fairly minor item.
What's that?
That will take, extension of time to pay. Yeah, it will take a 4/5 to add it on, Mr. Chairman.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. Those in favor signify by saying aye. 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 Those opposed, like sign. I believe that passes unanimously.
Was so, that the one with the people that were moving into the houses of Bank of America that had the receiver and all that?
No, this is another one. I'm pretty sure this is a different one. Okay. Gotcha.
Other changes?
Mr. Chairman, with respect to the secondary metals ordinance or resolution, This was the one where they, you had requested at the meeting for the sheriff to come and speak to the boards. Can we postpone that to the next work session? That'll just take a simple majority.
September 11th?
Let me find it.
16.
Is it 16?
Yes. 16.
Yes, sir. 16.
We have a motion. I'm sorry, do we have a second? We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, like sign. That passes unanimously.
Mr. Chairman, number four, my third request would be with respect to agenda item number three, board consideration of adding assistant solicitor general position. All I would ask here is simply that we change the title just so we've got a correct agenda for the record, and it would be adding assistant solicitor general position and accompanied administrative assistant. That's going to be the request made, but I think that's appropriate for purposes of accurately having the record on the agenda.
Second.
Do we want to move that to number one as well? So
Ms. Abernathy is here. I'm sure she'd love to get back to her business.
I would appreciate that. Thank you.
Okay. Can we do this all on one motion, or do we need to approve it on?
It's fine. Do both.
Okay. Both things are on this motion. Seconded. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. Those in favor signify by saying aye. Opposed, like sign. What else, Ken?
Last is a question for the board, and that is does the board want to talk about the issue of just the city county water IGA? It's not on the agenda to the extent, you know, we are talking about the invoices, but the actual IGA is not on the agenda. We're going to talk about that. Now is our time to add that to the agenda.
Well, I was thinking maybe we should have a special session about this Thursday, either a special call meeting Thursday. Shaking your head no.
No, that's fine. Of course that's fine. Yes, sir.
In fact, I would make a motion that we have a special call meeting, but I'd like to, I don't know what time.
That's 28th?
No. 30th. 3 o'clock?
How's 3 o'clock look to everybody? Looks good to me. Down here. And Tim Perkins, David Grumman. You're what?
I'll be away Thursday.
I can give it to you ahead of time.
Sure.
And we can put
it in.
Have it down and write it. I'll get with you also. That's some of the numbers that are.
You come just by the close.
All right. Is there a motion? I made a motion to have a special call work session. Regarding water and between the county and the city in the form of an IGA Thursday the 30th at 3 p.m. unless everybody has a problem with that.
3 o'clock?
3 o'clock.
3 o'clock. Yeah.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay. And that is a 4-0 with Commissioner Amos recused.
Thank you. That's all the items I had, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman, I would like to make a motion we postpone item 17, lost negotiations for September 11th work session.
Which item?
Item 17.
To 9/11.
What?
Can I ask why?
Basically, I just like to get some more information. I was out this week and I'd like to get some more information.
What number was the
17?
17.
Okay. Is that to the 11th?
Yes, sir. Yes.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
No doubt.
Did you second?
We have a motion and we have a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. Those in favor signify by saying aye. Those like sign. That passes unanimously.
Mr. Chairman, just for purposes of just updating the board very quickly, we have pursuant to the board directive at the last regular session sent the notice to Mr. Mills asking for selection of mediators.
Okay.
for law, so we are moving the ball forward.
Okay. Any other changes? If not, is there a motion to adopt the agenda as modified?
So moved.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, like saying that's unanimous. Therefore, I have an announcement then based on it may be a little redundant, but today, no, I'm sorry, it's not redundant. Today we have a special call meeting at 5 p.m. for the purpose of discussing and considering a bond resolution for Forsyth County 2012 bond refinancing. If the work session is not finished by then, the work session meeting will be recessed for the purpose of entering into the special call meeting and will be reconvened at the close of the special call meeting. That's the announcement. All right. Item number one. Is a request from Chief Flynn?
No, we do three.
That's right, three became one. Oh, that's right, it wasn't item one, it's an announcement. Oh.
Mr. Chairman, I'll take item number three, which has now become item number one. And obviously, oh, forgive me, we're not doing that.
There's an announcement number one before you get into it.
Well, I was already on a tear. So
but it's not your name on it.
That's right.
What?
Request
by
our
announcement
number one.
Our county
attorney.
Fire station.
This county attorney.
I got it.
Oh, let's
let it take
that.
Yeah, mine's county manager.
Can I just pass?
Yes, you want this?
I'd like to make an announcement.
What are we talking about?
At the September 11th, 2012 meeting, we're going to move from the table. On EMC agreement for electric service at fire station number four. Place it on the September. I got a councilman.
Chief, are you happy with that?
County manager, right there.
Oh, there you go. Is that what you wanted, Chief?
Yes.
Mine says county attorney.
Mine says county attorney.
Mine says county attorney.
I'm making an official record right now of what mine says.
Actually,
this is the one that matters. Yeah, well. This is the chairman.
I have.
Mine said County Attorney Junior.
Oh. That would have been me. Thank you, Commissioner.
Okay, we have that announcement made, and now items for consideration and discussion. Well, item three has been moved to item number one. Thank you, Chief.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. Thank you for allowing us to amend the agenda item on this as well. This is actually a request, and I will say this as candidly as I can make it. This is actually coming from not only my office, but also the Solicitor General's office, as well as the Chief Magistrate's office. I think it is fair to say we are all in lockstep with respect to the request that I'm about to place before you. And by way of history, just know that some years ago, and I cannot give you an exact date, it can be easily located, but some years ago, the magistrate had a request for there to be a prosecutorial representative in front of their courtroom. Makes very much a lot of sense. Not only are there civil cases in front of the magistrate court, but there are also criminal cases in front of the magistrate. And at the time, the Board of Commissioners, for whatever reason, it wasn't this Board of Commissioners, it was the prior Board of Commissioners, was not of the mind to authorize an additional solicitor position to fill that prosecutorial role. And so, quite frankly, given my office's presence in code enforcement anyway, the thought was, well, let's just let the county attorney do it. The county attorney has the authority to do it under the pertinent statute. And so my office began to prosecute what we call mixed jurisdiction misdemeanor cases in front of the magistrate court. And that has gone on for some time. I will tell you that at the origin of that, when we were originally conceiving to do it, it was considered then to be temporary, and I have used this analogy for some time, sort of like the school trailer that gets pulled up. It's meant to be a temporary, and unfortunately it lasts a little longer than anyone had in mind. And I have gotten to the point, just with respect to how my practice is growing, I'm right now attempting to replace some positions. And I've always sort of had to have one foot in the water of a true criminal prosecutorial practice. And that has guided some of my hiring decisions and how I equip my office to be able to handle a very small sliver of what I do. And I am also just not of the position, of the opinion that I am able to manage that like I would like to be able to manage it. It's nothing I do. I don't do that. I don't prosecute criminally, nor do I have a criminal defense background experience. So in speaking with Leslie and speaking with Walker, the chief magistrate, we're all of the opinion that it might make sense right now. This would be a good time to perhaps transition this criminal prosecution role back to where it belongs, and quite frankly, where it's always belonged, and that is back to the Solicitor General's office. There are a whole host of reasons for that, not the least of which it provides continuity, a seamless transition between cases that move from magistrate court to state court. And quite frankly, it's what the Solicitor General does, and it's not what my office does. And so I'm coming to you today, and I think I speak on behalf of the Solicitor General, although she's obviously here and can tell you exactly what she feels. And of course, I did speak to the Chief Magistrate earlier today, and we are just kind of all three of us asking if the board, in its indulgence, would consider funding both an assistant Solicitor General position as well as an administrative assistant to the Solicitor General's office to fulfill this role. I will still handle code enforcement prosecutions. I mean, I write a lot of the ordinances. It makes sense that I'm prosecuting those. I know them well. I'm happy to do that. I like to do it. I enjoy doing it. But with respect to these mixed jurisdictional criminal matters, truly criminal matters, I'm really to the point where I'm asking your indulgence and perhaps transitioning that to the agency, not the department, the agency where those belong.
So, Counselor, the real politique question to this is, how bad do you want to do this?
I really feel strongly about this. This is one of those transitions that just makes sense on so many different levels for a lot of different reasons.
I accept your argument. I was referring to financially, how bad.
You know, it's interesting. I mean, we have been able to do it for a relatively limited expense, but there are a lot of tangibles, intangibles, quite frankly, that I think outweigh any sort of cost savings you might enjoy. And I don't suspect at the end of the day that the cost differential will be extraordinary by any stretch of the imagination. I mean, we have been billing you for this work, but it's not a large part of my practice. With the addition of a Solicitor General, not only could that person, I mean, again, I don't mean to speak for Leslie, but they could probably do this and then obviously meet some needs that the Solicitor General otherwise already has.
Yes, I do. And previously in my 2013 budget submission, I had requested a new assistant solicitor and a new administrative assistant to go with that person. If you go ahead and make a mid-year budget adjustment and allow us to hire in those positions, we'll be able to easily assume this work and not have any additional increase that other than what was anticipated in 2013. And I do believe that this is the appropriate time to do it. It was meant as a Band-Aid at the time. It seemed like a better management of cost. But at this time, it is no longer a tenable situation to have for us in the prosecution of these cases. It is going to be really sort of a wash at this point in terms of those costs, and with the increase anticipated in 2013, this is just a really good time to do it. Kim wants it done so bad that I have been to magistrate court twice already personally to handle these cases so that no one from his office had to go, and so we have already assumed those duties as of, I think it was August 7th, and started court there on August 9th. And we are managing that, but barely managing it. They have court for the concurrent jurisdiction cases every other Thursday. And on those dates, we typically also have state court criminal cases with Judge Smith, our chief judge. And those dates overlap and provides us with an inadequate staffing level for the long term to be able to cover those courtrooms. Also, with this request, I want to renew my request for your consideration on the reorg that we had put forth, because having this new person and having them at a satellite location, a location off campus of the main courthouse where the administrators are, gives us challenges in supervision. And in order to maintain a professional prosecution at an off-site location, we need to have supervision. And what that means in my office is that we are able to have the staff where we can send someone to observe what they are doing in court, which we always do annually for evaluations anyway, but so that they're never in a position to be poorly supervised. And I think professionally that's very important. Ethically, it's mandated by the Georgia Bar that I am responsible for those that work for me and their professionalism and their ethics. And I do not feel comfortable having someone working off-site, not very well supervised, and I believe the reorganization will address that. And right now, in our budget, we have the budget savings in salary to cover that reorg from now to the end of the year, and we also have it in 2013. So it's not going to be a budget issue. I confirm that right before stepping in here with finance.
Pleasure of the board.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion to approve the adding of an assistant solicitor general position and related administrative assistant position as presented by the county attorney and solicitor. And you looked at the positions back and the finance and all that. Good.
Well, the I can't speak regarding the
finance.
I met with Ms. Ream and finance right before I walked in here to confirm where we were currently in terms of budget savings for covering the reorganization aspect. In terms of hiring in the new people at the midpoint, which would be my request, that would take a budget, a mid-year budget adjustment to cover that cost.
Do you have the dollar amount? I have the dollar amount. Let me just withdraw that motion and then you'll give me the amount. Yes, sir. And it's time sensitive, necessary, because we're trying to do a midterm. Yes, it would be preferred. I can only do that so long myself.
And right now that is what it is. It's just me rather than Ricky's out in this.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, I make a motion to approve the request for a new assistant solicitor general position with a midpoint budget adjustment required to meet the salary of $62,982 and assistant position with a related budget adjustment to meet the salary of $42,497.83. Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. I believe that passes unanimously. Now we are to what have been item number one, I believe, which is a review of the request by the Grand Cascades Community Association. Let's see. Are any of the folks from Grand Cascades here? Does anybody have the email?
Okay.
From Chris Faulkner.
You got it?
Yeah. It's in the book. Okay, thank you.
He replied back to Mr. Klein, and I'll just read it for you if you want. He just said, we appreciate your interest in the 319 grant program. Hopefully I can provide some clarification to the questions below. We regularly receive multiple applications from a single applicant. However, it is our policy to limit the number of projects an applicant can receive in a year. We typically cap that number at two, but depending on funding levels and distribution of those funds, that is not a guarantee, as we do try to distribute our funds as evenly as possible. Number two, he says, while your project sounds like it may address your needs, it would not be selected for funding through our program. We do not provide funds for dam rehabilitation, retrofits, removal, and or construction. This is prohibited under EPA rules. Also, we do not pay for dredging except in very rare cases. Dredging would only be considered if evidence shows that all upstream sources of precipitation have been addressed. Please also note that due to a shift in EPA funding priorities, the most competitive projects will be accompanied by a watershed management plan that is not required under a permit and addresses EPA 9 elements of watershed planning. Number three says 319 funds can be used for projects on private property. However, the project contract must be held by a government entity, and they hold subcontracts and or memorandums of agreement with any private entity. Number four, he says, we anticipate receiving roughly $3.66 million for fiscal year 2013, and that will most likely provide for between 6 and 10 projects, depending on the amount of funding requested and approved for each project selected. Note that all projects are capped at $400,000 federal, i.e. $319. I hope I provided you the information you're looking for. Please let us know if you have any other questions. Mr. Klein did reply back to that email, but there's been no response from APD. So that's the answer we have thus far.
Can I ask the board's indulgence? Can we make this decision as the last thing? I may have received an email from them, and I can't remember what it says, and I don't have it here with me now. From Mr. Klein. Or from somebody at Grand Cascades. If we can do this at the end, I will either produce the email or admit that I don't have one. If we could.
I did send you an email. I don't know if that's what we're talking about, but they may have as well.
Yeah. And somewhere in there, I thought that they had asked for some sort of a postponement, and that's what I'm really looking for, whether they asked for this to be postponed or not. Can I make a motion to put this as the last item? Without exception. Is that okay, Ken?
It is, sir. That's fine. No motion either.
Thank you. Item number two is presentation by American Water Company. Are they present?
Mr. Chairman, they are not. They have requested an additional postponement. I have this on my notes. I did not read it to you when you were setting the agenda, but you can postpone it now to the next work session if you agree.
Now, they postponed on the 7th. Postponed it again. They
did. They're waiting to get feedback from the city of Atlanta with respect to the viability of one of their deals up in Dawson, and that's why. And so I think they're just waiting.
And they've asked to postpone till when?
They probably need to postpone till later than the next work session, quite frankly, if they're waiting on the city of Atlanta.
Can we make a motion that literally says that we postpone the discussion with them? Well, until such time as they produce this letter from the city of Atlanta.
I think a table would be appropriate, yeah, because when they signal that that impediment's removed, we'll take it off the table and then put it back on.
Is there a motion?
Make a motion, we table.
Sir.
Thank you. We have a motion to second. There's no further discussion. Please vote on the motion. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, like sign. That passes unanimously. We are at item number four. Approval of carrier and plan selection of medical and dental carriers for 2013.
Yes, commissioners. Northwestern Benefits is here to present the 2013 benefit plans to the Board of Commissioners for consideration. And we have Susan Weatherly with us to do the presentation. And then we ask that a decision be determined regarding the carrier selection and plan selection as a time-sensitive item.
I
Thank you very much. We do have quite a bit of information to go through, so I will try to be as brief as possible. Please stop me at any point with questions. The primary thing that I wanted to do was make sure that we catch up on why we are where we're at and kind of set the stage on what we're looking to do. Every year, the county's plans renew January 1st. We begin an RFP process on behalf of the county, typically in June. This year, the two plans that we are looking at are the medical and dental coverages. Everything else was in a rate continue. Our incumbent carrier is Cigna Healthcare for the medical plan. We partnered with them 2 years ago. We are actually in the second year of a three-year administrative agreement with Cigna. However, due to the fact that some of the claim savings and programs that we were hoping to benefit from Cigna have not actually materialized, we decided to go out to the market a year early to see if there was another partner out there that may be able to help. The renewal itself, I have noted on the screen. We'll also look at it on a financial worksheet that will help illustrate it a little bit better. We were originally an administrative lock of $35.12. Due to competitive data from the market, we were able to negotiate with Cigna, and they've lowered that fee down to $23.47. They are willing to lock into another three-year agreement at that rate for us. In addition to that, we were able to negotiate a $30,000 per year wellness fund. So this is just a pool of money that we would be able to pull from any kind of wellness initiatives that we're looking to do for the county. And that's also for the three-year period, so a total of $90,000 there. The stop-loss contracts that we have in place do renew annually. The claims have been higher than we had expected over the last 2 years. So we are incurring an increase on this product from 4032 to 4675. The good news is that it is a pooled product. We're not being rated just on the county's experience, so we were able to save considerable dollars because of that. Also, our aggregate pool, so our complete risk, the full risk for the county. Originally, that fee was staying the same. Because we negotiated lower expected claim cost, they did have to increase the fee for that program. So that is going up from $587 to $747. The fixed costs on our renewal really are not our concern with Cigna or any of the other carriers that we were looking at. The most important piece are the claims themselves. Primary driver in that are going to be the network discounts that a carrier can offer us, and also their ability to manage the plan on the back end, whether that's through case utilization or disease management and other wellness programs. With Cigna, the preliminary projections came in at 27% above where our current claims are running. That ended up coming down to about a 17% increase. But it still has us going from a current maximum of $15.2 million to a projected maximum of $19.4 million. When we look at your overall renewal with Cigna Healthcare, we're coming in at a $19 million plan maximum, which is a $2.5 million increase over the 2012 numbers. So given that that is where we ended up with our incumbent carrier, we did look to the market. We had several viable options for the county. We were able to eliminate a few of the carriers that had come back, and we ultimately decided on Coventry Healthcare. They are a local company. For those of you that have been around for a while, Coventry bought the old Principal medical plans when Principal decided to go out of business. They have a very strong network in Georgia. Their claim discounts are equal to, if not better than, Blue Cross as well as Cigna in the market. They have come in very aggressively on the current plan design. We currently have a single plan option for the county members. We are looking to expand that, but if we were just comparing our current plan that we have in place. Fixed costs alone, we would save $200,000 a year by being with Coventry over Cigna. Additionally, they were willing to offer a $60,000 per year wellness fund. So that's another $90,000 over the three-year period that we would have over Cigna for the fixed cost. When we get into the claim projections on the financial worksheets, we'll see that Coventry at our maximum risk is offering to save the county a considerable amount of money. One of the initiatives that my firm had over the last year and a half was to restructure the plans that are available to the county employees. We eliminated a plan last year to really eliminate some confusion that was there between the two plans that were originally offered by Cigna. We have since come back and taken a look at a couple of different plan designs to put in as a second option. We're looking to make this second option the new county-sponsored plan that the main employee contributions will be based off of. And I don't know who's operating my slideshow. And then the employees would be given the ability to pay a little bit more and buy back up to the current county plan offering, and we'll look at those in a little more detail. There is a second option on the table with Coventry. It's one of the reasons that we chose them. It's a very different plan design. No one else in the market offers this type of plan. It's very sensitive to employees utilizing primary care physicians and utilizing generic pharmacy, and then really making them a direct consumer in the remainder of their decisions around their health care on how they want to spend their dollars within that plan. So we will take a look at that as well. Just so it is out there, these are the carriers that we solicited. Some of these are strictly stop-loss vendors that we had looked at letting Cigna administer our current plan and then potentially partnering with a different stop-loss company. You can see many of the people did not feel like they could be competitive on the plan. Blue Cross Blue Shield, we did originally have them within our presentation. Of course, Cigna is our incumbent. We did also look at Kaiser as an option. We call it a slice option, where you would actually have had two carriers in place, whether that would have been Cigna and Kaiser, and the members could have chosen which carrier they preferred. With the new plan design that we would like to present with Coventry, it accomplishes a lot of the same things that a Kaiser model would accomplish, and we felt it was less confusing and less of an administrative burden to have a single carrier with two options rather than having Kaiser and another carrier. So we eliminated them from the pool as well. And then you can see the remainder of the stop-loss carriers on that list. Optum, Sun Life, and Sun Metro were not able to put out a competitive bid for the county. In this section, I just wanted to give everybody an idea of where we're going as a county with the claims experience. We were able to take numbers all the way back to 2005 in this slide. We look at a per covered employee cost. So it's an aggregate pool on a gross basis. If we boiled it back down to a single person, how much would it cost to cover one employee on the county plan? And back in 2005, we were at $7,447. This was below the national average. The national average is that blue dotted line. We were running relatively well as a county. And even 2006 and 2007, we were just slightly increasing and reaching national norms. But you can see as of 2007, claims really took off. We were well above national norms. The green line is a trend line to say, if in 2005, if we just had a trend increase every year, which would be about a 10.5% increase, where should that number have been? And you can see in 2008, 2009, we're much higher than trend. We experienced a good plan year our last year with Blue Cross. 2011, the move to Cigna, and you can see how those claims have then continued to rise at a dramatic pace. There's not a single business or municipality out there that can sustain claims increases like this year over year. So we're hoping that by partnering with an alternative vendor and putting in an alternative plan design that we might be able to help turn some of that around. Based on the number that we're at in 2012, our underwriter would have expected about 16% increase in claims, which is roughly where we ended up on the Cigna renewal. So we are in no way saying that Cigna is pricing your plan unfairly, given the way the plan has run and their ability to administer the plan. They're right in line with where they should be. We just feel that there are other options out there that need to be considered. One of the components that we needed to review was how is the plan paying for the medical services for the members? This slide is really noting the total net paid claims, whether it be pure claims or what they call capitation, which is just another way that doctors are paid. The county had $11.4 million in claims. Of that, the members through either co-pays or deductibles only paid $1 million of the plan. So the county is paying 92% of the overall claims on the plan. We'll see a little bit later when we're actually looking at the premium cost share, what does the employee pay out of their paycheck? That number is even lower for an employee. It's more like a 95.5% split. So just to make sure everyone is aware of just how much of the cost the county is paying. On prescription drugs, we have a very traditional co-paying program in place. Not surprising to see about an 85-15 split. We often see more of a 75-25 with the way co-pays typically work on a medical plan. Really no concern here, other than maybe higher than maybe needed brand utilization over generic within the plan that could save the plan money. That's illustrated here. We do have very good tier one, or what you would consider generic utilization. And you can see the low cost to the plan, $22 for an average prescription on that tier. It's great that we have 72% of the members utilizing that. Our problem gets into tier two. Tier two drugs are drugs that do have alternatives. People are choosing the brand over the alternative, and they're costing a considerable amount of money to the plan over the tier one alternatives. Tier three drugs really can't be avoided. Those are the higher specialty drugs. They often do not have an equivalent. They are more expensive, but they're only 6% of our utilization, so not quite as much of a concern. The reason I'm pointing this out is the alternate plan design within Coventry could help address some of this through utilization. Any questions or anything I need to clarify before we move on to the financial?
Why is the mail so much higher than we do?
Because they're getting a 90-day supply filled at one time. So if you divided that by three, you're getting back down to a better cost, but it depends what they're having filled. So some of your more expensive tier two medications are probably going through a specialty pharmacy, which is considered a mail order. You've got drugs out there that cost $3,000, $3,500 every time somebody fills them. So it's gonna artificially inflate that mail order number.
What is the difference between a generic drug and a non-preferred?
The generic drugs are the ones where the brand has come off patent and other manufacturers have been able to duplicate them. Your non-preferred drugs are typically specialty pharmacy medications, so injectables, things like muscular sclerosis drugs, antiarthritics tend to fall into that tier. Any type of drug that a member is typically going to go to a doctor's office to have administered is going to fall into this. There are also some drugs that are on patent that there is no equivalent at all, and they're just very expensive, so they get put into that tier three non-preferred.
It is nice to see a large peak number of people already going for the generic.
Yes, 72% absolutely is a great number. We didn't include kind of the laundry list of what people are taking, but there's still a considerable number of prescriptions that are available through the generic that are not being utilized in that way.
Has anybody done any kind of, probably not you on this one, but anybody looked at the medical plan trend analysis in 2010, why they think it dropped? And is there any relevance to this at all, because we don't have a true pension plan in our county? Folks not retiring and staying on this plan longer. Typically, as we get older, we have more claims.
that I wouldn't be able to answer.
I don't know if you pay for this instead of that, or is any kind of
the average
relationship?
I will say your population is an older population. Absolutely. However, if we isolated just your high claimants that are really the larger impact to your plan, they are not your oldest members. They are in that pool of 30 to 55, kind of that average age. We're not.
The claims coming from spouses too.
Yes, we have a very large number of claims coming from spouses. Yes, significant.
The higher pool.
The other issue that we found on the plan, which doesn't speak to your 2010 question, and I was not the consultant on your plan back in 2010, but there's a lot of overutilization on the plan in general, that if you look at the number of physician's office visits and inpatient and outpatient facility charges against Cigna's normal data for a municipality or a private business, if the normal number is 16, you guys are at 19. Everything's just a little bit high.
What do you suggest that might? Okay, I guess you're
going to get that. Yeah, and I will get there with that new plan design that we're looking at.
I might add to your question of 2010 versus 2011. One of the things that we did do, we had in place in 2011 two plans, and they were PCP-based. We were a primary care physician. When we moved to Cigna in 2011, there was not a primary care physician and plans, and so that really, I believe, had a big impact, and also led to more utilization. We really, really tried to drill down what is that difference, and it was a big increase in claims, and we just. A visit of just going there, and I think the primary care physician type of plan did help to monitor that and manage that better.
Okay. And hopefully we can see that okay on the screen. What we have at the very top of the page, we're looking at Cigna and Coventry. The blue is Cigna, the green is the Coventry plan. Option A on Cigna is, what does the plan look like today? Option B and C would be the two plan designs we would be looking at renewal, and then to mirror that option A and B with Coventry. Option C with Coventry is the new plan design, which we'll talk about in more detail in a moment. At the very top, we are simply talking about what type of contract that we have. We are under a paid contract with Cigna, which means any claims that have been incurred under Cigna, they get paid, they're under the stop loss agreement. If we move to a new carrier, we will need to buy a different kind of contract. We have that noted. Any claims that were incurred in 2012, if they're paid in 2013, they will be honored under the new stop-loss contract if we move to Coventry. And that's noted by the 2412 under the contract types. We do have just under a $3 million runout protection offered by Coventry, so we feel like we do not have a gap by making a carrier change if that's what we decide to do. Under the first blue section are the fixed costs. These are our known administrative costs. What do we pay for our insurance contracts, the individual stop loss, and the aggregate, as well as any administrative fees. You can see at the bottom there, Cigna did give us a concession on their current contract. It's about a $46,000, $47,000 savings per year. They also have the $30,000 wellness fund. And then you've got just under $200,000 worth of savings by moving to Coventry. Majority of that seen in their admin fee, but as well they have lower stop loss fees as well, and then the $60,000 a year wellness fund that's offered. The most important piece is the variable costs. Where do they believe the claims are gonna come in? How do they think that their discounts are gonna be able to help, and any programs they're gonna put in place? Ultimately, the carrier is saying, how much risk are they willing to assume to take on the county as a partner?
Cigna, they've had the last year and a half worth of claims experience. They are going to be on the conservative side. For your current plan, if that was the only plan that we offered, you'd see all the way down at the bottom of the page. Is this a pointer?
Yeah.
Yeah, all the way down here at the bottom. They are saying at max cost, you were right here at $19 million, as opposed to the $16.5 from our current year. They do believe that there will be a $2.5 million increase. That is at maximum cost. That is not to say that's where the county will end up. But if you're going to budget, we feel that it's more prudent to budget at your maximum risk. And if we end up with a shortfall, we can do something about that on the back end. There is a plan that we are proposing as a second option. We'll review the plan details in a moment. It's this column C. If this was the only plan that we offered and everyone was in this plan, it would take us down to the 17.8. It would still be a $1.3 million increase over our current expenses to have just that plan. If we offered the two, people are going to choose between the two, wherever it ends up, we would fall somewhere in the middle on our maximum risk to remain with Cigna. Coventry, under column A, for our current plan, is coming in right at $17 million. We know that our maximum risk is just a little over $500,000. To do the second plan that we were offering there at 14.7, we would save $1.7 million just by having that plan in place. Again, if it's a dual option with our current plan, we're going to fall somewhere between a $1.7 million savings and a $500,000 increase. So just given that, I feel that Coventry is definitely a viable alternative to our current solution. The third plan that we are looking at, what we're proposing is that the core plan would be this plan here. It's a $2.7 million savings from your current plan. It is a very different plan. We'll talk about the plan design in a moment. But by offering that plan and having employees electing here and here, ultimately the county, even at maximum risk, should end up with lower costs in 2013 than in 2012. Questions on financials at all? I do want to talk about these plans that we're looking at. The blue plan is the current plan that's in place. The top section is the deductible, the coinsurance, and the out-of-pocket. This section here, this impacts people when they need hospital services. This is inpatient hospital, outpatient, lab and diagnostic, outpatient surgery. It is not physician's visits. It is hospital services. If somebody needs the hospital services as an individual, they pay a $500 deductible up front. The plan then pays 90%. The member pays 10% for another $1,000 for a total out-of-pocket of $1,500. They have a family, it's a total out-of-pocket of $3,000 for hospital services. If they are only seeking services in a physician's office, it comes to this benefit here. Primary care style physicians are 15 and a specialist is 45. There's no referrals required. People aren't electing a set primary care. It's just that style of doctor. You then have an emergency room copay, and pharmacy falls into copays as well. Very traditional plan. Copays do not accumulate up towards the deductible or the out-of-pocket. They're really three separate components of a health plan. You then also have the out-of-network benefit available as well. The first option that we were looking at would be B. This would be for Cigna or Coventry, increasing the deductible to $1,000 for an individual, $2,000 for a family. It adjusts the coinsurance from 90 to 80, and then they have a max of $2,000. So really the added risk is $500 for an individual or $2,000 for a family if they need hospital services. This is not going to impact everybody on the plan. We did also change the copay structure to a $25.50, and then the drug card, we left the generic or tier one at 10, increased the brand in tier three to try to steer some more people towards the generics. This is kind of that middle of the road, very traditional dual option approach, would save the county a little bit of money to do it. The plan that we really liked that Coventry brought to the table is what they call their $1,500 choice plan. They are the only carrier that I'm aware of that offer this plan standardly. I'm sure we could have gone to a carrier and asked them to piece it together. This plan has a $1,500 deductible for an individual. It's $3,000 for a family. And then you're covered at 100% for hospital services. The different thing on this plan is when you get to this section right here, if you go to a primary care, you pay a $25 copay. If you go to a specialist, you're going to pay a $50 copay plus your deductible. This is going to make people stop and think about whether or not they really need to go seek services with a specialist or if they could go to a primary care first. They are protected. Once they get to that $1,500, the deductible stops. The next time they go to the specialist, it would just be a $50 copay. They're kind of back in this bucket. You do have all of your urgent care and emergency copays, everything you need there. The other difference on this plan is your drug card is subject to your deductible. If you get a tier one drug, you just pay a $10 copay. If you're getting into these other tiers, you pay your deductible and a copay. The biggest difference on this is tier four. We are asking what are the non-preferred drugs currently with Cigna, and I'm talking about this high price injectable drugs. With Coventry, those fall under a tier four drug tier. They are putting a higher copay on those drugs. Again, I said they're $2,500, $3,000 per prescription drugs. Again, people are protected with these numbers up here once they've met those parts of the deductible, whether it's through pharmacy, physician's office, or hospital services, they are capped at that deductible at $1,500, and then copays would continue on the physician and drug card just as though they would on a traditional plan. The main thing that this plan does is it makes people stop and think, do I have a choice? Do I have an option? Can I be a prudent consumer and take a generic alternative or go to see a primary care physician rather than going and self-referring myself to a specialist or taking the higher cost drugs. We absolutely understand that not everybody has a choice, which is the main reason that we want to leave this plan in place with the ability for a member to pay a little more out of their paycheck to have that plan back in place if this just really feels uncomfortable to them. At the end of the day, you've got a $1,500 out-of-pocket maximum for hospital service regardless of which plan you take. It's just this one may get you there faster and in a different way. Given the thoughts on the primary care and the overutilization on the plan, we felt that this was a good alternative to look at presenting to the members.
My understanding is the motivator for this is that if they go to the green Coventry option C, they'll pay less what?
They would pay less out of their paycheck for the plan, is what we're proposing. This would be the lowest price plan out of their paycheck.
How much less?
We haven't completely got there. I do have some examples of kind of where we're going, which we can definitely go to.
Can I ask you a question?
Yes.
On the Coventry option, your deductible is the sum of all deductibles,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
Where under the plan A, option A, it is not the sum of all the
correct
deductibles.
Under A and B, your deductible and out-of-pocket is simply hospital services.
Yes.
Under C, anytime something that is called a deductible, regardless of where you're at,
yes,
it will accumulate towards,
yes,
that.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
You're correct.
So you'll reach that deductible relatively quickly.
Yes.
Okay.
If you use a service. But if you go to your primary care, or if you use the tier one generic insurance on FedEx, it's actually the same. Basically the same.
Yeah. You know, this is the same analysis that we would do when we're looking at the qualified high deductible plans that you would be able to have a health savings account for. You're going to have a pool of people that are very healthy, very young, rarely go to the doctor. This plan's going to feel fine for them because they're not really utilizing those services. You're also going to have the pool of people who are going to meet that out of pocket because they know they've got something scheduled or they have a condition that is going to go in that direction. this plan's going to make sense to them because it's cheaper out of their paycheck and they would have gotten to that $1,500 anyway. It's that middle pool of people where we're really looking to ask them to become better consumers on the plan to say, can you make a different decision and spend the county and your money in a different way that makes more sense on the plan? And I think this one's really going to be a little tricky to see. Really, this up here is what the employees are currently paying. They're $29.93 a month. If we're looking at per pay period, which is this green section, right now it's $13.80 for an employee and $41.40 if you are a family. What we were proposing is, and let me skip one more. This is the Coventry with a $1,500 choice. It's page 17 if you've got your book. We were proposing that for the $1,500 plan, the per pay period stays exactly the way they are today. There'd be no cost increase out of their paycheck. It is a 6% split. So currently today, the county pays 95, the employee pays 5. We're proposing the employee pays 6, the county pays 94. And we would double that to 12 for them to buy back up to their traditional plan. So rather than paying $13.80 a pay period, it would go to $32.65. Again, this was just an initial kind of analysis. We do have some other pieces at work here over to the side. We do have our tobacco premiums as well as a new wellness premium that we're looking at. We absolutely did not want the members to have to pay anything more out of their paycheck if we were making that type of a plan design change. We don't feel like it's a considerable amount of money more out of somebody's pocket when they go seek services, but it looks very different and feels very different, and we felt like changing all of the components at one time would be more disruptive than really necessary. You can really disregard the math at the bottom of the page. We're not assuming how many people are going to enroll in the plans. You try to do that and rarely get it right.
Is there anything in this that encourages that encourages spouses to use the plan less or use another plan or something along that line?
The thought is, even though actuarially the plan is not a lesser plan than what you have today, it's going to feel that way to people when they see it on paper. We do have the spousal surcharge, so if somebody does have access to their own coverage, they do pay more if they want to stay on the county's plan. And they're fine to do that, they just pay the added charge. I would guess that some people are going to take a harder look at their employer's plan.
Some places prohibit you from going on a plan.
There are some people who do just complete exclusions. Culturally, it's not a great message, but it absolutely happens.
What do you mean by that?
I think it's hard for an employee to hear that their spouse is not allowed on their plan no matter what. I think people would rather pay more money to have their spouse on the plan.
They have eligibility somewhere else.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, only if you have eligibility somewhere. It absolutely, it's done all the time. I have not seen it done very often in the municipalities.
Have you heard of private industry offering money to their employees if they do not use their policy and go on to their spouse's policy, they give you additional money back in the check?
We don't see it as much as we used to, but it does still exist through a cafeteria plan that you're able to give them $50 a month to opt out of your plan as long as they can show you that they are on some health plan. We do have a couple of employers that still do that.
Is that something you think we should offer? You'd say this, right?
I think you're going to end up with adverse selection and your healthy people are going to end up opting out of the plan and you're going to be left with a pool of unhealthy people that don't have anywhere else to go.
Yes, she's there.
Our problem isn't our employee, isn't really our member base. Our biggest claimants now are spouses, and we try to tackle that as much as we can with the surcharge.
What is the surcharge?
It's $25 a pay period.
And that is for
I've got it, but just from out of curiosity, it says about 30 to 35 spouses hit the top numbers last year for us. Are they fairly new employees, or have they been around for a long time on average?
I would not have their identification. I do not know.
I don't know who they are.
Yeah, we don't know.
We don't link the claims to names just for that purpose. Yes, but I would hazard a guess that the spouses on your plan that are the cost drivers probably do not have access to other coverage. Or they may even be employed here and they're just
considered
a spouse on the plan. So we have a lot of the dual coverage.
Yes, sir.
One point to just bring up regarding Coventry is that they do not have an agreement with North Fulton Hospital, and that we did run the disruption report, and there are six employees that have used
them. Six or 16?
Six. Yeah, so we would reach out to those individuals to notify them should we go to Coventry.
Would you shift them over to North Side?
Yeah, we would definitely let them know the implications of what it would. They could, of course, go wherever they want, but it would be a much higher expense to them, and we would definitely reach out and make them aware of that so they can make that decision. The other thing that to bring to the table regarding Coventry is that it was recently announced that Aetna will be purchasing them. Anticipated date of that acquisition should be mid-2013. We do not anticipate any disruption in regards to that during 2013 at all.
What do you need from the board today?
We do need a decision from the board whether to go with Cigna or Coventry, and also which plan designs to choose. Then we would plan on the next work session to come back to the board based upon those decisions regarding the employer contribution mix and how that would fall out with the specified plans that the board chooses today and the carrier.
Besides the pros and cons that we saw on the numbers, what are pros and cons that you're aware of in the market itself between Coventry and Cigna and how they perform their services? And who is less of a headache, if you will?
I think it depends on who you ask on that question. If you asked all of the consultants in my office about carriers, they'd all give you a different answer. I think Coventry has...
You're being a politician right
now. No. I think Coventry is, at least while they are Coventry today, they are a smaller local, they're a more nimble company. They
have a ratio customer service.
Yes, the number of clients that a rep has is going to be less. They're a smaller, leaner shop, but I think it gives them that ability to be quick and nimble. We have had instances in the past with Cigna and Blue Cross where we would like something or need something to be adjusted, and it's taken months or it doesn't happen at all because they're having to kind of go up through corporate to get things done. We felt better about having direct local presence with who we need to be able to talk to on a daily basis being just down the street from us. Cigna does a great job with their programs and services. Unfortunately, the numbers just haven't ended up the way we would have expected them to end up. When you run network analysis in Georgia, Coventry has better discounts than Cigna does. Cigna is on a much more national PPO hybrid network, whereas Coventry and Blue Cross have the real true old HMO discounts. When you're looking at Cigna with a claim discount of 53% of billed charges as opposed to Coventry at 59%, the numbers speak for themselves there. As far as service and implementation, I think they're all, I give them all a B. Nobody's
completely flawless on all aspects. I think you're going to give and take on all areas. I don't think the membership's going to suffer at all. I don't think the employees are going to feel a huge difference. I think internally the personnel department is probably going to get maybe a little more attention than they've gotten in the past.
Let me ask you, Coventry, does if we choose Coventry over Signal, do the employees get to choose their plan, or we pick the plan and that's...
We'd like to select two plans, and then the employees would get to pick which plan they prefer to be on.
Okay.
So it's really whether or not we want to stay with Cigna or move to Coventry. And then if we do move to Coventry, are we choosing the traditional $1,000 and $500 payer, or are we going to try the new $1,500 plan with the $500
current plan? Another plan that costs less, but...
Option C.
Would you recommend, if we do choose it, that option C is one of the options that you also offer?
Yes, I would say don't take away the plan that they currently have.
And leave out B completely.
Okay. I guess I'll just roll back to that.
And in the Coventry C, would need a replacement for the current Cigna plan?
We would want to keep the current plan that we have in place.
Is A.
We want to keep A in place.
The $500 up.
Yeah. That's the A.
It's choosing between the 1,000 and 1,500.
A would be the replacement plan, seems. A is the new
It would be like the new
plan, new company.
Yes.
And then the C is the new standard.
Then
save employees. Opt to farm it, save more. That's how the paycheck. Correct?
Yeah. It'd be the same that they pay today for the first C, and then they would ultimately pay more to buy that
C on here.
I think that's what we decided last week.
On here.
Coming trips.
Yeah.
But the choice is to go just $1,000
or the choice. The whole plan.
Correct.
Did they get it?
So what do you need, Dave? Are you are we going to do dental?
We can go to dental next, but we'll have to come back to medical.
Because that's what I mean. You want to do a decision on this one?
It would be nice, yes, because that'll also help us then to move cleanly onto the next section. So the first decision would be, should we go to Cigna or Coventry?
I'm going to make a motion that we go to Coventry. I think he said something just because you're
here. Do we need to pick plans for Coventry or just go to Coventry?
Well, let's first do this and then we'll go to the plans.
Fair enough. Okay. So we have a motion for Coventry.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I'm so sorry.
Patrick, did you second?
I'm sorry.
We have a motion and a second to go to Coventry. Is that option C we're talking about?
No,
Coventry.
No, just the carrier.
Thank you. Yeah. All right. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, like sign. That's unanimous.
Obviously, it was not as fine.
Do you need to be time sensitive?
Yes, thank you.
Need to reconsider your vote. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
That passes unanimously.
The motion is to accept Coventry at a time sensitive basis.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, like sign. That passes unanimously.
Okay, the next decision then would be based upon the slide before you. You have option A, option B, or option C. And we would like the board to choose two of those options. As Susan has mentioned, her recommendation would be option A and B, or option A and C. Primarily, I believe you prefer option A and C.
And do we need to make in this motion that if we do choose A and C, that C becomes the primary, and what would the upgrade if they choose to pay the extra they can go to?
That would be wonderful. A. Yes.
and also time sensitive.
So moved.
We have a motion and a second.
Time sensitive. Do you have that? You.
I've got it up
today.
It's C being the primary with the option that was going to upgrade to option A.
On a time sensitive basis. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. Those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. That passes unanimously.
Yes.
Go ahead, Pat.
Thank you. Okay.
Mr. Chairman, just for purposes of the record, I don't think you mentioned any opposition. That makes it cleaner for me to hear it down here. I just couldn't hear it.
I didn't mention what?
Any opposition.
I
didn't hear all of it. That's all I'm saying.
Everybody raise your hand, those in favor.
I said that passed unanimously.
I just didn't hear
it. Universal sign.
We do have hearing in here.
Should I say it? Pass program? Passed unanimously? We'll get a digital sign down here.
Would you like to withdraw your comment?
I just need you to have something in your forehead that lights up. That's what I need.
Inside or out?
Okay, Susan.
Okay.
Dental.
So we will move on to dental. This was the other program that is up for renewal. We're self-insured on the dental plan as well. So ultimately, at the end of the day, it comes down to the administrative fee. We are currently with Delta Dental. They are asking for an increase from $293 to $358. We were able to negotiate that back down to $315. Not a considerable increase. One of the things that we were also charged with when we took over for the county was to redesign the dental program. We are proposing Guardian as an overall cost-saving carrier with a different plan offering. Just as the medical would have a dual option, we'd like to do that within the dental plan as well. We'd also like to restructure the contributions on the dental plan. We are not looking for an answer on the contributions today, just whether or not we would like to change carriers. We do have some of the people that we approached in the market. The majority of the medical carriers, we also asked to price the dental. Also some of the dental-only players, such as Guardian, MetLife, and United Concordia. We ultimately narrowed it down that if we stayed with Cigna, it probably made sense to stay with Delta Dental. But if we were changing our medical carrier, that we would like to look to change the dental carrier. We are looking at Guardian as that new option if we would like to make a change. Primarily the reason for that change is service or lack thereof, and lack of timely data that we get from our incumbent carrier. We don't feel like they have been the best partner that we could have in the market. The biggest thing that we are looking to do is to put in a dual option. The county has a very rich dental plan, which is this plan here, or this plan here, if we're looking at the dual option. It's a $1,500 annual maximum per person on the plan of dental benefit, 100% for their preventive care, 90% if it's basic, and 60% if it's major. A traditional dental plan in the market is 100 for preventive, 80 for basic, and 50 for major. And eliminating ortho on this base plan. What we wanted to do was propose that employees contribute a little bit more towards the dental coverage, use that savings to offset medical expenses. If we were going to do that, we wanted to offer a lower cost alternative as the base plan. Again, let people buy back up to the old plan if they wanted to do that. Guardian was able to come in with a much more competitive offering, which is about a 22% decrease over what we currently pay for our dental program for the county.
It just so happens, it seems like for a long time, whatever companies I've been with seem to have Delta Dental, and from a user's point of view, I just don't ever remember having any kind of a problem with them, even though from an administrative point of view, maybe they could be better. Do you, And believe me, other than that, I don't know about these things. Do you feel Guardian will be on parity roughly with Delta in terms of how the employees get?
Yeah, we did, down here at the bottom, we did a network analysis. You know, dental coverage is not really insurance, it's coverage. And really what matters is if there's a network, who's got the larger network in the area we're talking about, as well as the service from the carrier. Delta is considered the largest dental network because they have an ancillary network that's behind their primary PPO network. Dentists typically are not going to join a dental network unless they're trying to build their practice. If they have been in business to have a good practice, there's no reason for them to take discounted prices. You'll notice down here that some of the some of the dentists that were in Delta, obviously not all of them are in Guardian. But then on the out-of-network side, 50 of the 183 would have been in Guardian. So it's kind of a back and forth on whether or not your dentist falls into the network. At the end of the day, we want the best price for the employee. We also want the best price or the best service for the employee. I'm not completely married to us moving to Guardian. They were giving us the ability to offset some costs. Had the new enrollment system that we're putting in place as part of the wellness initiatives that allow us really for the first time to not worry about having different partners in that arena. And I think that was maybe one of the reasons why the county has kind of stayed where we've been, is that it was difficult to move. But I understand a lot of larger employers, they have Delta Dental. Because they have that extra ancillary network. I don't know that you're needing to buy that for the county.
What's on the rates? 2831.
Yeah. So what we did to try to make the dental plans so you could compare them easier was we asked the carriers to say if we wanted to come and buy this as a fully insured plan, we're just going to pay a premium, and the claims are the claims. These were what the premiums would have been to buy these plans. And you compare those against the premiums that Delta Dental would have been offering. If we'd been fully insured, they're saying that it's a $939,000 for the plan, whereas Guardian's saying they would have only charged you $700,000 for the same plan.
And you're talking about the split is between the county and
yes. Yeah, absolutely.
But we're self-insured, so it's paying
that. Yeah. And the plan on the left, the new base plan, has the one...
Yeah, it's $1,000, $180.50, no ortho. There's no point if you don't need ortho to pay for ortho. And we do have adult ortho on the plan, but yeah, you're ultimately paying to have that benefit there regardless of whether you're using it.
And that's a monthly cost, $28.
Yes, that would be a monthly cost if we were breaking it down in that way.
We're currently charging a couple dollars.
Currently, your employees are paying $3.27. No, I'm sorry, they're paying $1.05 per pay period. For dental.
With
dental. Yeah. They're paying $3.15 a pay period for family. One of the things that we were asking to do is to take this new core plan and ask the employees to pay 25% of the cost on all tiers, and then if they want the old plan back with the ortho, they're paying to have that.
So it's still like $7.46.
In this preliminary,
And to also be able to break that away from the medical, so you can pick just dental if you wanted, you don't have to go on a medical plan, and just pick whatever plan you want there. Because not everybody, necessarily.
They want to have good teeth, but it doesn't matter if they broke.
Right. Or they may have medical elsewhere.
Well, and I think right now the county also says if you choose family coverage on medical, you have to have family on dental. This is going to allow people to choose family for medical and employee child for dental because maybe their spouse has other dental coverage or vice versa.
Yeah.
So.
And that's possible only from the electronic enrollment because that'll really help to do that. Otherwise, there'd be too many moving parts to manually handle.
We will have that electronic enrollment this year, right?
we're working very diligently towards that, aren't we, Kevin?
Yes, ma'am.
So,
did he just promise to have it done?
Absolutely, he did.
Now that we got that other monkey off his back, it should be a snap.
It should be a snap, so.
So what we're asking of the board is to determine, choose a carrier and approve the use of adding a current plan and a new base plan.
Well, before we get into that, one question, please. If you switch to Guardian, what do you think the percentage of people that won't be able to use their dentist when they all accept Guardian or not?
Well, this is what we did down at the bottom. These are in the last 12 months. Who utilized services with Delta Dental, and were they in network with Delta? 379 claims were in network. With Guardian, 70% of those claims would be. 100, and I believe that's 63.
Yes.
Were out of network with Delta. If they were with Guardian, now 50 of those would have been in network. So you're doing a little trade-off. Ultimately, 83% of the claims that were covered under Delta, or in aggregate, 83% would match up.
Do you know how many people that relates to?
They were just broken out by total claims.
Yeah. That could be just a handful of people.
Oh, those are physicians. Those are the okay. Physicians. There were 379 dentists. Dentists. There were multiple people going to see those dentists.
Yeah.
But when you look at the claim dollar analysis, it breaks out roughly the same. And you're going to have people that maybe wanted to go to a dentist but couldn't on Delta and now can on Guardian. And
they
can
go out of
network.
The benefits
too. They can go out of network. The benefit on dental when you go out of network, they pay what's called the 90th percentile. You go to the dentist, the bill goes in to Guardian or Delta. In that zip code where the dentist office is, they look at what 9 out of 10 dentists bill. Whatever that rate is, that's what they're going to pay off of. So it's not like medical when you go out of network and it's a ridiculously low number. There are going to be people when they go out of network that go to the aesthetic dentist that are going to charge a lot more than the normal dentist would, and they can be penalized for that. But the majority of the time when it's 9 out of 10, there's not a big penalty to go out of network.
So with Guardian, you're saying we could save $300,000?
That's what they're projecting. It's not a known given savings because you're self-funded, and ultimately the claims are the claims.
You said Delta left some things to be desirable in terms of reports. Do you know for sure that Guardian does not leave the same things to be desirable?
Not in my experience working with Guardian.
You've had good experience?
I've had very good experience, and I believe that their customer response unit in Wisconsin is the number one customer response unit out of any carrier.
Okay, with the dentist, you know, a lot of times the dentist likes your carrier to pay them quickly and all that. Do they have a good reputation with the?
They do have a good reputation in the industry. The one thing that I'll say about Guardian is they are they stick to their contract, and they definitely stick to their contract.
Where's that dentist when you need it?
Okay, so you need a choice.
Carrier implants.
Yep. I guess so with Guardian, you only have with Delta Dental. I guess that has two plans: dual option and current, or just Guardian. It's just
really ultimately, you could choose to have a single option with Guardian if that's what we'd like to do. Either way, we can have a single. We could either have Delta or Guardian, and then whether or not it's a single or dual option.
Split it for.
Can we do this as a all-in-one motion with this one?
Good.
Yeah.
Yes.
Is it
time
sensitive?
And time sensitive.
Yeah. All right. So I'll make a motion that we use Guardian dual option for the current and the new base plan as our carrier for
motion. Do you have a second?
All with guardian.
On a time-sensitive basis, if there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, like sign. That was unanimous.
See that part, though, that last part? That was painful to me, that last part. Little silence at the end of it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So you'll be coming back and letting us know.
Yes. Next work session, we'll be coming back to the board with with options for employee rates based upon this carrier and plan selection.
More accurate.
Absolutely. And you can drill down.
I'm doing my job.
Thank you. Thank you, Ken.
Okay, I think we are on to item number five.
Chairman and members.
Brands manager.
Chairman and members of the board. Item five is a request for approval to apply the state of Georgia for section 319 non-point source and implementation grant of $282,000 with required match of $188,000. Authorization for chairman to sign any related application documents. This is a motion for us just to apply. The budgeted amount is in the department's 2013 budget request. Grant funds will be used to finance the stream restoration project in the Big Creek watershed at Fowler Park. Item is not time sensitive. Applications are due in October. October? They're doing October.
First or 30th?
I think they're doing 31st.
Project that's located across the street from the fire station.
Herbert Auto Repair Services. This is actually somewhat of a win for Georgia Power, because it is the most economical route for them, and a win for fire station number one. That would give them a secondary underground loop in the event their primary was disrupted through somebody digging it up or a catastrophic failure.
How is it, or what piece of equipment knows, or what has to be done if one or the other goes out to switch to the?
It'll be a manual switch.
A manual switch.
Yes, sir.
When the lights go out, throw the switch and hope they come back on.
That's correct. It's actually a third redundancy. They also have a backup generator, power station.
And no cost to us other than
no
cost to the easement. Have you talked to the chief and he's happy with this?
Yeah, the chief and also the senior staff at Fire Station 1 met with Georgia Power. And all of us are in agreement that this would be the right thing for the county.
On that, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a recommendation we approve the underground utility easement agreement between South County and Georgia Power for the county owned property located at 234 Kessler Road. Time sensitive.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, like sign. That passes 4-0. Commissioner Tan being out of the room. Thank you.
Thank
very,
you.
Very much. Sounds like a great deal to me. Item number 8.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. We are asking for a change order with our auditing company, Molden Jenkins, for the 2011 audit. Until they come in to do the audit, we're never sure how many single audits that will be required per the regulations based on the federal funds that we get. So we had to have a total of 6. We had one included. As this is over 10% of the contract cost, we have to come before you now to have a change order in the amount of $17,000 with Molden and Jenkins. Thank you.
Is this $17,000 plus the $81,000?
No, it's $17,000. The $81,000 has already been approved, sir. So yes, it would be on top of the
$81,000. My only question is, we've been using Molden and Jenkins for a couple of years now, have we not?
Yes, sir.
And from where I sit, when they've reviewed our situation, we get pretty good reviews. Is the fact that there's a change order is a little bit of a surprise, just because we have a history with them. Is there something a little different this year or something?
Until they actually come in and they can add to this, but until they actually come in and start our audit, they're not sure how much federal funding we receive and how much funding we get actually dictates how many single audits they do. So it's always an estimate. So the good side is that we got the federal funds. The downside is that we had to have more single audits this year than we had the previous years.
Does this happen normally every year?
Last year I did. Mm-hmm. Last year we came, I think we had to add one. Top my memory. This year we had more.
Okay. Their auditing requirements mandate that they audit a certain number of federal programs. And so until they get into which federal program we have, and it's hard for them to even ask that.
Okay, sense. So is there a motion from the board?
Yes, sir.
Make a motion we approve the change order from all those people to LLC to be about $17,000.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, like sign. There are none. That passes unanimously. Do we want to ask about previous votes, or we're okay?
What's that now? What did you say, Tom? That's fine, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, sir.
Item number 9.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. This is an agreement we had actually already, the board had awarded for provide cleaning services to various Forsyth County facilities. We awarded it to American Building Services Providers, and we have had some cleaning issues with them, and we actually sent them a cure letter saying we wanted these items to be addressed, and they came back and said we'd rather just cancel that contract. doesn't happen often, but it does happen. The second lowest bid, we have reached out to them because this is a time-sensitive item. We are very tight time constraint. The second low bid had been the company that had been providing our services previously. They are willing to hold their price as they presented to us in their bid documents, and they'll hold that price through December 31st of 2013, actually. There was no cost increase. So at this time, we would like to award the bid 1187-1620 to Building Maintenance Services in the amount of $208,192, and that would, like I said, take it through December 31st, 2013. They're very similar, Commissioner Bell. We had awarded it to American Building Services, which is ABS, and then we were going to BMS, which is Building Maintenance Services.
The ABS should have dropped out voluntarily, withdrew their contract.
People do underbid sometimes.
It's a very tight bid. All of our cleaning companies sometimes are very tight at any given time. He had worked with the county many years ago, and it's a different animal now. We have more buildings and a lot more requirements.
And this will be put out for another bid in December?
We'd like to go until next year, if the board's in agreement, instead, since they'll hold that price.
We want to go 2013?
Please, sir. That would be the preference.
It would actually be about a little over $52,000 for the balance of 2012,
right. Okay.
And then about $156,000 for 2013.
Right.
Are they assuming American's pricing for the rest of this year?
No, it's their pricing. It's the total overage, which is about $2,700.
$2,000.
Yes, sir.
Do we need to do a budget adjustment?
We can probably cover it within the department.
Because he has extra funds within that line already for additional cleaning services, so we've already verified that there's funding available. And there's funding available for next year as well. And this one, again, we are asking it to be time sensitive so we can have the service start in the beginning of September.
Mr. Chairman, I'm making a motion that we accept the bid 11-87-1620 with Building Maintenance Services in the amount of $208,192. This shall run through December 31st, 2013.
Item 16.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, like sign. There are none. That passes unanimously.
Mr. Chairman, real quick, I want to revisit an item you mentioned with respect to Commissioner Tam coming back in the room. That'll work with respect to him getting with the clerk for items to go on consent agenda, because he'll be voting on them again by way of the consent agenda. But item number 7, I believe, was approved time sensitive, and there'll be no other opportunity for his vote to be cast if he intends to have it recorded on the minutes as being in favor. So that will need to be taken out in the open. So Commissioner Tam, if you want to cast your vote in favor of that, you'll need to announce it now. I'll just have to record what you want here. That's right. That's correct.
That was just funny.
Unless you want to help get another one in my vote the right way.
Yeah. It's four.
Okay, item number 10, I believe.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. On this one, we are asking for an amendment and notification of termination of the consulting agreement between the county and ARC-MP Incorporated. That would take effect September 23rd of this year.
What are we terminating for?
Then do you want to answer that?
Yeah. This is with a company, ARC-MP, which is Wally Grambling. We have discussed this issue with him, and believe this is to both parties' mutual benefit. It does provide us a 10-day
10 days in advance of said termination, that we can mutually agree to terminate this, and it will also, if you vote to approve it, will manifest our intention to terminate this agreement on September 23rd.
Amendment does two things. To do something else?
We may free up some options.
Yes.
Flexibility.
And I think the plan is to come back to the board later with those intentions. Okay. Right now, I think we need to go ahead and agree to move forward terminating the contract.
I just want to be clear that, you know, if you know nothing about this, it could seem that there's a problem here and we're terminating the agreement or something. That is not the case.
That is not the case. Yes. That is okay. A mutual agreement. That's correct.
All right. Is there a motion for the board, from the board?
Mr. Chair, I make a motion that we approve the notification of termination of the consulting agreement by the Forsyth County and ARCMP Incorporated. You need a date for that, Tim? Just about a...
No, it's not time sensitive.
Not time sensitive.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Amos, just again, you, I think what you said was a motion to approve the notice of termination, and forgive me, it is an amendment, because it's the amendment to the contract that allows us to then terminate within 10 days. So forgive me if you could clarify your motion.
Yes, sir. I meant to include the amendment.
Thank you, sir.
In there now.
Thank you.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, like sign. There are none. Therefore, that passes unanimously.
Thank you.
Item number 11.
Mr. Chairman, this is a request to hire Arcadis to perform engineering work and services all the way through the construction of a project. It's a capital improvement project. It's in our CIP, approved CIP by the board. When the county purchased the Manor facility in the contract, there was a requirement for us to seek a cold weather discharge permit. We made application for that permit, received a waste load allocation from the EPD. The next step is to do all of the necessary work to get a discharge permit. You go through similar steps as you would for a 365 discharge. You've got an environmental engineering document that has to be prepared, anti-degradation report. So there's a lot of environmental work that has to be done. Arcadis was one of our design services companies, and they're also the company that designed the Manor facility. Through Donna's office, Barry Lucas and my staff negotiated. This is a not to exceed contract proposal. So if things move through faster, you know, we won't exceed this. It's their estimate. But we request approval to move forward with this so we can go after that cold weather season discharge permit.
A motion from the board. If not, I'll make a motion that we approve the Arcadis proposal for engineering studies and permitting for cold weather discharge from the Manor Water Reclamation Facility.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed, like sign. There are none. That passes unanimously. Item number 12.
Mr. Chairman, this is an associated project. Also with the Manor, where it's a discussion of the need for additional wastewater. We bought the facility because there was additional wastewater capacity in it that was unused in the area. There were a couple million dollars worth of capacity available, but we have to pump wastewater to get it there. They also had a need for treated wastewater for the customers for irrigation purposes, the homes themselves, for a water balance for the golf course in the homes, needed the additional reuse water. We charge those customers roughly $130 a month for treating their wastewater and providing them the reuse water for irrigation purposes when it's available above what the golf course needs. While in the contract, we did, it's not an absolute requirement
to do this project. It has been in our CIP for several years. It was also included, the ultimate line will be $2 million, pump station portion. We had this designed a couple of years ago before things started slowing down. We pulled it off the project, moved it back. So we need to finish this design, brush it off. What I was about to say, technical memorandum that the board hired CH2 and Hill to do in evaluating the purchase of the facility included $2 million to build this pump station in line, along with a possible $1 million reuse line to get to the manor. And all of that was included along with the purchase price of the plant in the evaluation that the board received. And then they ultimately made their decision to purchase the plant. So currently, the homeowners there in the manor are not happy because they don't get to irrigate their water. The golf course needs most of it. So they're very upset with us as a provider of reuse water because this line is not in. Delivering the additional wastewater there will take care of that. And it also takes some relief off the Fowler plant. It will delay an expansion down the road from the Fowler facility. We'll be removing the flow that currently would go there. So it's been part of the plan since the manor plant was purchased. Even though it's not the contract, Ken may want to talk about the discussions the board had, the golf course and the HOA were all but promised we would complete this line. And Ken can discuss that if you have any questions.
Everything Tim said is accurate. That's all consistent.
Tim, what's, I'm sure it's considered here, but I'm not looking at it right. What is the cost to do this?
This engineering work is estimated, it's against a not to exceed number depending on encroachments that may have happened since the design was started. That's $89,415 to get us ready to bid this project out. Plans have to be finished, some work has to be done, a survey, and we know of a couple of walls that have been built adjacent to the right-of-ways, so we're going to have to move and redesign a couple locations because it's been 3 or 4 years. We've got to resubmit the nationwide permits. Wetland permits have to be resubmitted. We have to get permits from Forsyth County, from Tom's office. They put a bunch of money in there for that.
I do have a question. We don't have a per se bidding multiple companies on this. We merely have Hayes James Associates.
They did the
initial work.
They did the initial work. Yes.
All right.
Again, they worked with Donna's office on this project.
Okay. I'd like to do it.
Chairman.
Take a motion for the approval for the engineering service proposal with Hayes James Associates for the Post Road Force Main and the Pump Station project not to exceed $89,415. We can make it time sensitive if you need
it. Let's make it. It's okay to make it time sensitive. It'll help us deliver the project.
I'll second.
Okay. We have a motion and a second if there's no further discussion. Motion, those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, like sign. There is none, therefore that passes unanimously. Item 13, Tim.
Item 13 is a request to hire Hayes James and Associates to prepare similar documents as we discussed earlier for the manor, but in this case it would be for a 365 discharge from the James Creek facility. We have a pipeline from the manor facility that's currently using, Windermere facility, that has a seasonal discharge. Those two plants are 800 feet apart. With things being different, DPD, we have the ability to move forward and ask for a 365 discharge. This takes flow away from our shake rag facility, the combined permit we have there. And Barry Lucas worked with Donna's office to negotiate a not-to-exceed price to proceed. We did receive the wastewater allocation from the EPD. We need to move forward with this engineering work.
Tim, if we
we're well on our way to constructing for the new shake rag. Would you still be keen to do this one?
Yes, we still need this one. It's just additional capacity above what shake rag and power combined will need. When it was privately owned, this was one of the things that held us up from moving ahead with that permit for a long time, the fact that it currently is discharged into our land application system. A lot of the infrastructure is there. It's not going to take a lot of infrastructure. It basically should be looked at as an expansion of our ability to discharge on top of what we're going after down at the shake rag.
What's the pleasure of the board? I'd make a motion that we approve the request of Hayes, James, and Associate proposal for engineering studies and permitting for a year-round discharge for the James Creek Water Facility.
Time-sensitive would be good.
On a time-sensitive basis.
So is it 98,000 or is it 112,960?
Bob, paperwork's getting 98,000.
Well, I'll just see 98,000.
Well, that is
not to exceed $98,000.
So it says she revised.
We negotiated some work out to reduce it.
We have a motion and we have a second for time sensitive and not to exceed $98,000. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. And I believe that passes unanimously. Update on the buildability of Boston Drive Lot.
Yes, this item was on the agenda on the 2nd earlier this month. It involved a variance for Larry Pierce on Lawson Drive. The focus of the variance was reducing easement from 20 feet down to 10 feet. The variance was approved. As part of the approval, there was a request that we come back and discuss the buildability of the lot. As you heard on the 2nd, the property has a fairly long and complicated history. And sorting through all that and trying to cut it down to just the real facts regarding the buildability, there's two remaining tasks that need to be completed, and they're dependent on the actions of Mr. Pierce. The first is that he'll have to record a plat showing his 10-foot easement, and approval of that plat will qualify him as having a lot of record. Once he achieves that, he then is eligible to apply for a building permit, and he has to comply with the standard requirements of any home trying to obtain a building permit in the county. For Mr. Pierce, appears to be the two most significant issues as part of that process would be showing compliance with setbacks and showing compliance with the county health department for his septic system. Now, those issues, again, are things that Mr. Pierce is going to have to deliver. I don't have the ability to create those documents and tell you here today, can he obtain a building permit or not. What I can tell you is Mr. Pierce has identified, he's confident he thinks he can provide all those documents, and if he provides them, I will be issuing a building permit for him in the future. Now, it's been back and forth, as you heard at the meeting, about is it really 10 foot, is it not? All that's going to be sorted out as part of the documents he submits, and he has indicated, like I said, that he feels like he can produce those.
Do you require anything from us at this time?
Just an update.
Do you have any questions, Mr. Pierce?
No, I don't have any questions. I got a survey with the 10-foot as a court order said, and I got that finished yesterday. I presented it to him this morning.
To the court
plat? Yes, sir. Yeah, they got it, and Susan Green's got it. So I was lucky to find somebody over the weekend, and he worked on it for me Sunday. So
and the other part you understand about the as long as you can apply with the setbacks and
and
department approves it.
Right, and
your good show there.
Yeah, and I had submitted that some time back.
Yeah, sure.
you know, a while back showing the 2,400 square feet and the 10 foot on each side.
I just want to make sure you're clear.
Yeah.
As long as you comply with those, you can go on about your business.
Right. Yeah, sure.
Okay. Well, that's something
that
we'll have to
help
the department look through that with you.
Yeah. The adjacent lots are in the same location on their 100 foot lots. They're behind the house. And so it's the same thing there, but there's never been one on this lot since 1958 when it was subdivided.
Good enough. Thank you, Tom.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Do you mind if I just add a couple things to that?
Sure.
Not going to.
Like I really have a choice.
Well, you do have a choice, and you can tell me down
the
house.
No, go ahead.
You know, clearly this has been an issue that has been going on for 3 years, and everything Tom said, I agree with. He and I have kicked this around, quite frankly, ad infinitum, trying to get to the bottom of this. The UDC is a fairly thorough document, but it cannot cover every potential issue that surfaces in the realm of land use. As many chapters as we add to it, there are just some things that are difficult to capture. This situation involving Lawson Drive has been going on almost as long as I've been doing work for the county. And there's just a couple things I want to raise to you. Because they've been raised to us, I want you to understand how we arrived at where we arrived at. Just so you don't, if you hear it for the first time out there in a public comment and say, why didn't you tell us about that in the work session? So here we go. One of the issues has been what Tom's already addressed, and that's that 10-foot access. Mr. Pierce can satisfy that by way of showing some sort of a survey document. That's fine. I mean, you know, sometimes Tom's office is in the job of getting, various bits of data that have been stamped by professionals or engineers, and they have to do their best. We don't have the resources to go out and do independent surveys of every piece of property, so we just have to rely on information. Sometimes it's given to us. Another issue, though, pertains to the buildable area of the lot. You know, the reality is that the lot that Mr. Pierce has is not conforming under our UDC. Everybody understand that? It does not meet the square foot requirements. So is it a lot of record? Well, that's convoluted. That's a convoluted answer, but we can know this. The lot next to it that basically was carved out of the lot he owns, thereby leaving him sort of a remnant, was stamped in 1993 by our planning department, thereby creating the lot that was carved out of his as a lot of record. Well, do you know what that did? You know what that meant as a matter of fact with respect to the remnant?
Except
it created it.
It made it,
because we stamped
that,
therefore we buy. And so that's the situation Tom and I have been dealing with, and I don't know how to say it except just to say it that way. In addition, there was a year 2000 Superior Court order on a quiet title action perfecting title in that same master lot. Well, it was by the owner of the remnant lot, deciding that bigger lot was a legitimate, fully titled lot. I think that's further judicial sanction of the remnant. If you understand what I'm getting, I mean, there's been two pieces of data that have played into our analysis. Does it fit smack dab squarely within the UDC? I wish it did, but your director has been given the power to make interpretations when there's tough calls, and that's the interpretation he makes, and I support it.
Would it be appropriate that, as we know, you know, people come and go from here, could we get a letter to provide to Mr. Pierce that gives him that, so he can put it in his file that if he comes back in 15 years, he's got something?
Mr. Pierce comes back in 15 years, Mr. Bell.
Mr. Pierce is going to be in Hawaii.
a narrative that explains how and why we got to this so that he at least has something in writing instead of having to go to the video?
Well, but it gets a lot of record once it's recorded, it's a lot.
Well, his will be, but we, you know, let's just call it what it is. We could draw a challenge off, you know, Mr. Brown's act of stamping that plat is an administrative action that might give rise to an appeal. And so we just need to be mindful of that. Another objection that has been raised is that the variance section that Mr. Pierce proceeded under applied to access to public roads. Well, here's the news. That area of Lawson Drive, where his property connects to Lawson Drive, I don't believe is a county road. I can't tell you who owns it, I just don't think we do.
But we own Lawson Drive?
We own some of it. But even if it's a private access road, the law, the UDC has another section that required a 20-foot access easement off a private road. So there was going to be 10 feet of variance needed, whether it connected to a public road or a private road. Once again, that is a big, convoluted legal quagmire. And I think Mr. Brown's done a good job of saying, look, you needed 10 feet, whether you accessed a public road or a private road, and you've got that from the Board of Commissioners. You know, everybody understand?
May I just make one comment? The two mega mansions that are $1 million on my left and $750,000 on my right, those are on that same road. It's a gravel road that goes back to when Lawson got the property from the government in 1956. So it never was improved, because the only time a house was built was when the doctors built their house in 06. It's 25 feet wide, but technically it's 14, and I got a letter from the heirs granting me the road. Now, as far as the 10 foot, and I'll just clarify this real quick, because it seemed like there's something about a 10 foot. Irrelevant, and there's somebody who's trying to create me problems, let me just say that. But irrelevant of if I were to tell you it's 12 feet, if Mr. Brown were to say it's 8 feet, the court order that was signed right here grants me 10 feet, because that's what I was trying to get in the beginning part of 08. So the court order here that was filed is 10 feet, no matter if God comes in here and says, I think it measures 8. It's 10 feet, that's what it says. Mr. called me, I think Thursday, said, can you get the order written up and done by a surveyor and attached as a pertinence to the lot? And so I called all over and found a friend that knew a friend and a friend, and Sunday he did it, and I picked it up Monday. So Tom's got it, and that's the requirement. So yes, this has been difficult. I've been through 3 trials, 3 9 years. This little easement, gentlemen, has cost me $70,000. The court, people that was creating the problems, the court awarded them $1,200. So this is what you call bullying of who's got money, push someone around like me, and it's been going on for 9 years. It's over. But there's still somebody coming up here that's creating problems. And I know Mr. Brown doesn't want to say, but I will. And, you know, I don't know how you stop those people, except that the court order here is 10. I was lucky to get somebody to draw this up the weekend. And, you know, I can't afford to lose any more hair over it. Thank you. I really appreciate everything y'all have done.
I'm almost done, and then I'll stand down. Two other issues that have been raised. One is, will the building be in the core, within the core line? That's an issue between Mr. Pierce and the core. And the other issue is whether there's enough square footage on the lot for a septic system. Again, that's an issue between Mr. Pierce and the Board of Health. From the Forsyth County Planning Department, we have contented ourselves as to where we are.
There's other issues or something we don't.
Item 15.
It's item 15. The late 2011, we started a series of discussions, and they were agenda items at work sessions. And the agenda item was titled the User-Friendly Initiative. It related to possible changes to the Unified Development Code. A good bit of the feedback for the changes came out of John Kiefer and Howard Carson, a committee that was working with the Chamber of Commerce at that time. And the end result of those discussions were a list we generated of 5 possible UDC changes that we would work on as time allowed. Today we're back with one of those changes, and it is the one that's focused on setbacks. The very general summary of the product is allowing, primarily comes up in residential, allowing the roof overhang to encroach into the setback up to 18 inches. Now, to get to that point, Jerry, a planner on our staff, I think some of you have met him, some of you may have not, he's been working on this. There was also some corrections in the UDC in general that had to be made to eliminate some conflicting language and things of that nature before we could incorporate the changes that came out of the user-friendly initiative. Those other changes are not intended to be performance-based, and you'll see that as you look through the ordinance. They're intended to eliminate inconsistencies within the document and match up to how they're actually been permitted for a decade or more now. with that, I'm going to turn it over to Jerry and to give you a summary of the changes that are in your agenda book.
Commissioners, as Tom noted, there are three different items that we've looked at in the throughout the UDC. The first one being setback encroachments. We have now allowed setback encroachments up to 18 inches of the following items: gutters, overhangs, footers, sills, belt courses, cornices, chimneys, and other architectural features as determined by the director. So those items are non-structural items, just decorative parts of a house that we now will allow 18 inches within the setback. We've also taken out of the definition of setbacks the exemptions, things that are totally exempted from the requirement unless otherwise stated throughout the UDC. This is such as fences and freestanding walls, uncovered entrance platforms, and steps and patios which are on grade. That is the first thing that we did. The second thing was we looked at the definitions of setback and the definitions of yard. And the definitions basically complemented one another, and they said they were the same. Throughout the code, that's not the case. There were some places where setback was intended and some places where yard was intended. The quick abbreviated version of what was changed is that a setback is the required space, the minimum required space from the street or side property line or rear property line to a structure, and the yard is the space that actually exists between the front of the house and the front property line, or the rear of the house and the rear of the property line. The differences come into, for example, for yard, when we talk about in some commercial districts where zonings, where parking is allowed, in some cases it specifies that the parking needs to be in the rear or the side yard of a property. When the definitions were the same, the setback, you know, saying the parking was going to be in a setback is obviously very different than saying it's allowed in the yard. So we've cleaned it up. In places where we've meant setback, where we're looking to require something to be a certain distance from a line, we've meant setback. In the definitions where we're talking about what's allowed between said building and property line, we've said yard. So that's the second example. And the third thing that we've done in the code is that we've added determinations and other things that the department's already doing. For example, odd-shaped lots, how you determine what the front property lines are, where the front property lines are, where the setbacks are, where the yards are. For example, property lines that have multiple, or properties that have multiple lines, flag lots, and triangular-shaped lots, where it wasn't clear throughout the code exactly how you determined what was what. We took what the department was doing, and we put it in the code, not only in words, but in some places we've added diagrams and examples. So those are the changes we have made, and if you have any questions, we'd be happy to take those.
In addition to what Jerry covered, you'll also see the last two pages of the text in your books. It deals with a change we ran into over the last year or two, where the current wording prohibits lot combinations and boundary line adjustments unless the lots are conforming to all the requirements of the code. I couldn't come up with a good rationale on why we want that. If we have a non-conforming lot, and typically it comes up because of a size issue, the lot's too small, our current wording says you cannot combine that lot with another lot. The proposal in front of you would strike that and say, if you want to combine a lot, you can combine a lot. And it doesn't have to be a conforming lot to do that. So that, in addition to the things Jerry covered, this is our first work session. Answer any questions, and what we're looking for at the end of the day is, are you ready for this to move to a public hearing, or do we have some more work to do?
I have a question, if I'm understanding the concepts right, and this probably does not relate to a residential structure, I don't think. But it sounds like what we're saying is that you can have parking in a setback, is that correct?
Parking is allowed in the setback, yes.
If you are allowed to go into the setback any distance, aren't there going to be some cases where a place that you could otherwise park, you cannot now park because you're 18 inches into it with a gutter, a window dressing, or some other kind of thing? Or are you going to declare a level above the parking space where you can encroach the 18 inches into the parking space?
Well, the two, in today's wording and in the proposed wording, the two are entirely independent of one another.
Which two?
Overhangs and parking location. We don't regulate parking location based on overhang day, and the proposal would not either.
But so you do allow them in setback.
We allow parking. Them, parking is allowed in a setback, that's correct. And with the proposal in front of you, 18 inches of roof overhang could also be in a setback. And if it came up for a proposal before us wanted to have the first 18 inches of a parking space covered for the roof overhang, there would be nothing that we would try to stop that.
Oh, so let me ask you this. Doesn't a parking space, a la commercial, have a dimension?
Yes, it does.
Okay, and if you're 18 inches into that dimension because of an overhang, don't you have to then move the parking space? The guy's going to park his car and drive it into your gutter if the gutter is low, very low, or the window dressing is very low compared to the parking space, potentially, is he not?
That's what I was thinking about.
Well, only depending on the lot, you can have a lot that comes behind a house and the gutter is 5 feet off the back area.
And it's one of those things I think, based on reviewing permits for over 10 years downstairs, I haven't seen it come up in the past. We don't regulate against it now. We could add that kind of language if the board thinks it's appropriate. But the best I can tell you is we don't prohibit that from happening now, and it hasn't.
But I thought it couldn't happen now. You can't.
No, because parking isn't exclusively limited to setbacks. You can put parking anywhere on the lot you want. So even today, you can put parking adjacent to your structure, and your structure could have overhangs as long as you weren't right on the.
Okay. All right. It's not limited to setback. Okay.
That's right.
You could put a house too close to. Trucks get filled all the time because it's too close.
That's generally not considered a good thing.
No, it's not.
We're looking to hear in general if you think this is ready to move forward to the planning commission.
Is that a motion?
Do you need a motion, Tom, or do you need?
We do typically have a motion when we go into a public hearing.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. Those in favor signify by saying aye. Those opposed, like sign. That passes 4-0 with Commissioner Levent absent the room at the moment. See, item 16, I believe, has been postponed. 11, same with item 17. Which takes us to item 18.
We're just going to ask the board to rescind the approval.
It is identified in the agenda book as reconsideration. Commissioner Bell is correct. Rescission is the actual proper term.
I
don't
want to do it now. It's too costly.
How much is it? What was it?
So it's in addition to the 45 that had been.
So the motion is to rescind the approval to repair the house located in the near line and
can we have a little
discussion?
Is this something that cannot be used because it's got ADA compliance and stuff?
Well, that was
is the tearing the tearing it down is odd.
Public, when they looked at it for. It's on the
artist.
We will let them use it originally. It's too costly to buy it. We could use it as a rental home for security. doesn't have to be ADA, or the rental homes don't have to be ADA. But, so it could be used for a private individual, but not for public use.
After
it has been, after it's been stripped, they've been out there busting the counters out, they've stripped all the copper out, they've stolen the air conditioners, busted the windows out, and it is torn, slashed.
It's just cost prohibitive to do it.
Oh, okay.
It's a shame, you know, that house was like brand new when we acquired it. It's just too costly. Now, if we want to just let it sit and hope that we can use it, but the more it sits, the more liability is. Somebody just puts it out there and messes around.
Must not turn it in.
Okay.
So. Jerry, do you have anything?
No, you don't want it for anything, do you?
All right, we have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. Those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, like sign. That passes 4-0 with Commissioner Lent being outside the room at the moment. Item 19.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, item 19 is a proposed settlement agreement between Forsyth County and Bank of America, N.A. This arises out of a letter of credit related to the Vermont subdivision where Forsyth County actually was the plaintiff and brought suit against Bank of America for that $55,000 obligation. You have in front of you a settlement agreement for $40,000, and based upon the issues presented in the litigation, I can recommend that. I think it's a reasonable settlement, and I think that Forsyth County has, at a minimum, made a point with Bank of America that we're going to keep coming back and back until we get a range of numbers that we are comfortable with, and so I appreciate the board's steadfastness on that. So my recommendation is that you do accept the settlement agreement and approve it on a time-sensitive basis.
I was going to hold the issue unless you wanted to. I make a motion to approve the settlement agreement.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion.
I'd like to just add something.
Yes.
Counselor, are we going to,
have that meeting?
As we move forward, are we going to work with engineering and all to come up with some criteria on some of these issues?
There are a host of issues with respect to just...
Not necessarily Bank of America, I'm talking about...
With respect to this paradigm or this subject matter anyway that my office is working with engineering on, and we will be bringing this back to the board. This is just the first step of a lengthy process.
Yeah, but we're going to come back with a criteria that we accept them in the form.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, like sign. There are none. That passes unanimously.
Thank you.
Item 20, Old Atlanta Rec Center License Agreement.
Mr. Chairman, the Parks and Recreation Board approved the Old Atlanta Parking Permit application. I passed out Exhibit B. That's the only change, and that's what we handed out to the students at Lambert High School to fill out and keep on filing. For their applications.
Jerry, do you want to get a place for them to sign if they somewhere up here?
They've got another application you got to put, but they also
received.
That's
a privilege and right, if they understand it's a privilege and right.
Right. That's Exhibit A, I believe.
This is an exhibit to the contract, so when they sign the contract, they're agreeing to this.
Right.
And the reason this is back in front of you is since your initial approval of this, we have worked with Jerry, worked with Tim Merritt, we've worked with staff, to make that, we've cleaned the document up, quite frankly. And so I'm bringing it back to you to ratify one more time. But now the Park and Rec Board signed off on it. This thing is ready. Actually, the next step will be to go out and actually have students and their parents or guardians execute it. We'll bundle a bunch of them up. You may find them out there on a consent agenda, but it's going to be this document.
Right. Where's the, Tim? Where's the money? Did Park and Rec collect the money for us and put in their budget?
Yes, sir.
That was in their Christmas party.
It'll be shown as revenue. It'll be shown as revenue to the Park and Rec. Yes, sir.
I'll make a motion that we approve the Exhibit B as handed out by as presented by staff with respect to the Old Atlanta Recreation Center license agreement. I believe, is that time sensitive there?
Commissioner, I want you, if you don't mind, and forgive me for this, I want you to approve the whole agreement, including the handed out Exhibit B.
Okay, well then I move that we approve the whole agreement with respect to the Old Atlanta Recreation Center license agreement, adding Exhibit B that was handed out today by staff.
Yes.
And making it time sensitive.
Second.
Second.
Got a motion, a second.
If there's no further, if there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, like sign. There are none. That passes unanimously. Other than to say you can't pay for this with credit card.
We take credit cards at the rec center. I guess they
can.
I don't see it on.
So they go into, where are they going to buy these? At the old John rec center?
Yes.
They go in and buy
right
them?
There.
You got a credit card machine.
Yeah.
So they don't take credit card money.
Yeah. Commissioner Baum.
Oh, it says in a check for $300 at the top. You might want to put.
Hard.
It's up to you guys.
Don't take forever. So.
Chairman Bob, I think the reason for that is we got that form from the Board of Education. It's their form. We altered it slightly so it would apply to a other than school property, and so that's why you see that.
Okay. Item 21, I believe.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, item 21 is a proposed intergovernmental agreement between Forsyth County and the City of Cumming with respect to certain land acquisition. I just want to let you know that I have taken the IGA, I provided it to my counterpart at the city, and at this point, there has not been any feedback with respect to whether this would be acceptable at this time. So I wanted to give you that update and say we've done, you know, what we've said we'd do and try to get it out there, but I would request this be postponed to the next work session.
So moved.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion.
So would that be till Thursday or till?
Till the next.
Next
September. If
there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, like sign. There are none. That passes unanimously. Item 22.
Mr. Chairman, item 22 is a matter involving an intergovernmental agreement between the Board of Elections and Registrations and Forsyth County and the City of Cumming. And this was a matter that you, the Board of Commissioners, in good faith in August, I think the August, the last regular meeting, you approved an amendment to that IGA, which would have provided a little bit of flexibility with respect to room location, et cetera, et cetera. Well, that went over to the City of Cumming, and the City of Cumming has declined to approve that at this time as well. They want to wait till November to reassess. In the meantime, though, I want to bring a matter to your attention because I need to ask some indulgence from you, and that goes to the notion of the original IGA, the July 2011 IGA, that I reported to you out in the work session or the board meeting had been approved by you. Actually, it had been approved by the Board of Registrations and Elections, and I believe there was some confusion on the handoff between the election supervisor and the county with respect to what we've approved it means. And unfortunately, the yield of that is that we executed a document that had not been approved by the Board of Commissioners. And I think it was a good faith error, but it nonetheless occurred. And I've talked with the election supervisor about it. She's very apologetic and just said that traditionally, I want y'all to understand this, traditionally they do their own contracts with their poll locations. So the notion of the Board of Commissioners also having to approve this just was something that didn't even get on her radar screen. And it's something that I required, though, or was requiring in my form because it was an IGA. It wasn't with the local church or some other poll location out in the county. It was actually with the IGA. So, you know, it was a good faith mistake by Barb. She was very comfortable authorizing me to tell you that. But the practical result of it is I need you to ratify the July 2011 IGA, because as far as I'm concerned, it's not been ratified by the Board of Commissioners. It's been approved by the Board of Registrations and Elections.
Wow. And you just do whatever?
You jump off the bridge?
He makes a lot of money.
He was usurping your authority.
Is there a motion from the board?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, like sign. I believe there was no opposition, therefore that passes unanimously. And we're on to item number 23.
Mr. Chairman, item number 23 pertains to a parcel. I've been calling it the Densmore parcel. It is located along McGinnis Ferry Road. Its tax parcel number is 090177. It is a, I've got the actual size of the parcel. It's a 0.742 acre parcel. That is, as I mentioned, along the right-of-way of McGinnis Ferry, and in a future road project, we are going to need about half of this parcel, and John's here and he can correct me, but my understanding is we're going to need about half this parcel of property. I understand from the lawyer representing the property owner, most of it, the balance, is in a floodplain. Well, they have gone ahead and they have issued both an executor's deed and a quitclaim deed to give it to the county. Not only have they given it to the county, they've recorded the deeds. Well, y'all haven't approved it yet, and I would like you all to approve the acceptance of those deeds. And I actually talked with the attorney. I said, I just want to make sure I understand why you're doing it that way. And he just says it's property that because of its location in the floodplain, because of our future use of it, just wanted to go ahead and get it to us now. I would feel more comfortable if we went ahead and approved acceptance of this piece of property and these deeds.
Ken, just yes, so you know, the note that we have talks about 0.64 acre
The let's look at the, I mean, the deeds tell all. Let's look at the deeds. The deed I have provides a 0.742, and the executor's deed point is the 0.742. That's what I'm asking you all to accept, is the 0.742. John Brackley.
That's correct. Future okay. Widening project will shift north, so it'll impact this property. We'll also be building a bridge over Candy Creek at this property, so we're going to need, you know, a substantial portion of this property for a future widening project.
Okay, now I know of someone who has told me that they live in the area and they would like at some point to potentially acquire whatever piece that's left over that we're not using. Do you A, recommend that we do that or not do that, and B, if you recommend that we do that, should this person buy it from us? Who pays for the survey? Blah, blah, blah.
I think Ken could help me answer that, but I believe he could ask for abandonment of it since we're receiving it for free, and then if in the future it serves no useful purpose to the public, then it can be abandoned free of charge.
Because we didn't pay for it, John's correct.
Yeah, the property owner would just need to request that, provide us a plat and deed, and a deed of abandonment and a resolution, and then we'll go through the process just like we do for any abandonment. I'll ask the board authorization to advertise. We'll have a public hearing. Once the public hearing is held,
does the survey have to be done and say this is ours and this is yours? And who pays for that?
The property owner that requests the abandonment would have to provide the plat and deed, all the required legal documents for the abandonment. But until the roadway project is designed, we won't know what we need. But once the roadway project's designed and complete, then whatever remnant is left, then a property owner could ask for the abandonment. Now, Ken might have to help me answer this, but typically when you ask for an abandonment, it's abandoned to the adjacent property owner. So the adjacent property owner would have to ask for the abandonment.
I agree.
That's my understanding.
Is it an adjacent
property?
Is he doing this for tax purposes? Is he taking a tax deduction?
My understanding is that I'm sure they will pursue some limited gift or tax.
This shows back taxes on here. Does that have to be addressed?
What does?
It says it shows back taxes of $1,400. Lower right-hand corner.
There'll be about that much left to put one on. You guys get
there. Yeah, Mr. Chairman, if they're back taxes, I don't know if this is accurate or current, but if they're back taxes, they have to be paid. I mean, we'd want them paid.
You want to postpone?
Yeah, let's do that. Is that okay, John?
It's fine, man.
Yeah, we'll postpone it.
I make a motion.
How much on
items?
$1,400.
Looks like $1,900.
That's total.
So they have to pay their taxes to get it to account?
Well, I would at least want to know. I'd want to vet that issue. I'm not going to suggest to you. If we're otherwise going to have to condemn it, we could quickly run up a bill a lot higher than that. But at least that's the sort of thing we'd like to get to the bottom of, and I'll bring it back to you.
So when it's September 11th?
Yes.
I make a motion to postpone this item until September 11th.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, like sign. There is none. I believe that passes unanimously. Item 24.
Mr. Chairman, I will take a go at this. As a result of some action taken at the last legislative session, a new law was passed that will exempt, commencing, I believe, in 2013, it will exempt sales tax over a four-year period on energy used in manufacturing. All right, so it literally will exempt that, quite frankly, from SPLOST and LOST tax collections as well. The same piece of legislation provides that the county and the city can meet together, and if they meet together and agree to it, they can impose a resolution or ordinance that will basically require the tax to be reinstituted. In other words, the state's exempting it, but the localities can independently excise the same tax.
The 2%, but they right. Still save the 5%, right?
Correct. So, and it would be phased in over 4 years. So what the state's taken away as far as taxes, the Board of Commissioners with the municipalities have the ability to reintroduce. So it's like a seamless handoff. Now, we don't have to, but we can. But if we're going to, we have to provide notice to the City of Cumming for a meeting prior to September 1st of 2013. So the reason this was brought to your attention was to say, if we have an interest in reimposing this tax that the state law is about to exempt or waive or stop, we have to start taking action fairly quickly to go ahead and have, remember like in SPLOST, we have to have this meeting with the mayor before we try and do a SPLOST? Same sort of a meeting.
I, for one, don't have any interest in implementing the tax.
Well, I can't say that. I don't kind of revenues.
Well, that's the key. You've already hit on the key issue, is what sorts of dollars are at play here. And that has been a little bit of a chore to try and find that information. Quite frankly, Dave Gruen can certainly assist. We have talked with the State Department of Revenue, and they're not even sure how to tell us exactly how much in tax dollars are at issue.
So, but right now we can just say we're going into negotiation with the city, but we can always opt out of it. We don't have to do
it. We don't have to do anything. I'm just saying we've got a deadline of September 1st. Once that deadline goes, you're done until probably January 2014.
What, do you need a motion to have the...
If you all want to even have this meeting with the city, just to at least begin to commence it, I believe, yeah, you need to make a motion. You need to make a motion to authorize us to invite the City of Cumming mayor to a meeting prior to, or to at least make the invitation.
What's the revenue derived from this?
It's sales tax on energy from manufacturing.
We don't know what we talked about. I'm just proving it's voluntary. We don't. It may be a little, maybe a lot.
We need to keep our options open until
we find out.
It may exceed easily. We try to get some grasp of these numbers. There's over 440 businesses that fall in this classification that are getting taxed for manufacturing for energy, and it could easily exceed $100,000 in our taxes. Perhaps a lot larger than that. Again, the state is exempting the entire sales tax, which is the whole 7%. What they're doing is they're giving localities a chance to get the loss that you would lose back if you want to re-implement it.
You said $100,000 annual or over the whole
easy.
Time?
Yeah. Annually. They consume a lot of energy and pay a lot of sales tax on it.
But we don't know who is taking advantage of it right now.
We don't even know how to find out.
It's just going to be exempt. They're not going to have to pay it anymore. It goes away.
Yep. And here you were wanting to try to save a little bit on your other taxes. You didn't do it in a timely manner, but this is even less.
Well, we don't necessarily like to cut taxes around here. We like to raise them. Yeah. We spend a lot of money on how to raise taxes.
I'd like to cut taxes.
Well, I believe we need to look at what number you're talking about.
I'd like to know where it's coming from, the shortfall coming from.
I would make a motion that we postpone. Can we postpone this until the...
I have to have... We can. The letter The media doesn't have to occur by September 1st, but the letter has to be issued before September 1st to the mayor.
This year, well,
yes, sir.
Why don't we go ahead and issue the letter?
Well, just issue the letter. We know we're locked out.
Can't we?
Yeah.
The letter doesn't trigger our obligation. In fact, the letter sets the stage for us to be able to adopt an ordinance later.
Later.
But we don't have to do that.
Supposing we chose to get rid of this tax, in order to get rid of this tax now, we have to have this meeting.
No, in order to get rid of the tax, we need to do nothing.
Do nothing.
The tax ends January.
Well, we need to find out how much it is. Yeah, but to go on with it, if we do nothing, we lose it.
Yeah.
But if we don't do something,
we need to do something and find and see if we can find out.
We need to have the meeting. We need to get the data to see what it is before we make any decisions.
It should be happening, you know?
All I would need would be a motion to draft a letter inviting the mayor for a meeting for purposes of discussing the energy excise.
Yes, sir.
So moved.
Second. That has to be time sensitive.
Yes, sir.
Time sensitive. Time sensitive.
Yes, sir.
Time sensitive.
Second. Time sensitive. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, like sign. There are none. That passes unanimously. Item number 25, I'm just asking for the sake of everybody, does anybody need to take a break or should we?
Well, I was going to ask, item number 25, why don't we make that item number 2 on Thursday?
Is that a motion?
Yes.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, to make it item number 2 on Thursday. Ken, do we need to advertise anything special about that? Second item.
No, sir. I mean, nothing special about that. It just needs to be advertised in the ordinary course.
Okay. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. Those in favor signify by saying aye. Those opposed, like sign. There are none. That passes unanimously. I assume that means nobody needs a break, so we'll go on to item number 26.
Mr. Chairman, item number 26 is a proposed modification to our pending real estate purchase agreement with GE Commercial Finance Business Property Corporation. This pertains to the so-called Baldridge property that we have envisioned acquiring for purposes of the sheriff's headquarters. You all may remember this. The contract price was $1,790,000. That was pursuant to the, I think it was in June that we adopted the initial agreement. It was July 5th. During our due diligence, we have discovered some things and have gone back to the seller and asked that they reduce the price based upon that due diligence. And in fact, they have agreed to reduce the price by $290,000 down to $1.5 million even. That would require a contract amendment. This is an amendment in front of you. I got that right. Yes. And this is the amendment in front of you. Now, this would be time sensitive, so you would need to approve this to make it a part of the contract.
Okay, well, what's the date on that
Is it still an ordinance? Somebody made a motion.
Mr. Chairman, this proposed amendment, Mr. Mayor, you advised me may be premature.
Okay.
And so probably we may need to discuss this in executive session with respect to pending land acquisition.
I agree.
Right. Thank you. So what do we do? Just
we can just move along.
Go on the agenda.
Move on.
Item 27.
After 27.
This is mine because Karen Smith, who is opening a delicatessen over in the mall over there, which I hope is wildly successful, has asked to right next to where Mellow Mushroom used to be, I believe, in that building itself. Karen Smith, who was my appointment to the Park and Rec Board's open, and what I haven't been there, but described to me as a high-end delicatessen.
She was smart about
it. What's that got to do with Park Rec?
She's tied up and has had to resign from that.
Oh.
And has asked, The Boss Burgers.
Boss Burgers.
I said high end.
I said high end.
Is the Boss Burger going to deliver? High end.
They made it right.
Yeah. And she, I do not personally know Mr. Dabbs, but I've talked to him on the phone. She has recommended he take her place, and so I wanted to A, announce that Karen is unfortunately resigning, and B, ask if I can get support for an appointment to Steve Dabbs to the Forsyth County Parks and Rec Board.
I also met him the other day, introduced himself to me over the west from Dry Side. So.
So that's my motion is to appoint Steve Dabbs.
It was in practice.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, the motion, those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, like sign. There are none. That passes unanimously.
She's retired.
And we're on to item 28, which Councilor added, Carol Ann Property.
This is a fairly simple item, I believe. This pertains to a matter of which you approved pursuant to our policy with respect to a fine and sedimentation reduction to Caroline, which is the receiver, with respect to property owned by Eastbrook Properties. We had reduced the fines by way of agreement from $71,000 down to $17,000, and provided they had 30 days to pay. They have requested an additional time to pay of basically 2 weeks and are asking that we ratify that by way of a contract amendment so they can have this additional 2 week period to pay. And I'm trying to find you the precise date. Fine shall be paid by September 4th of 2012 if the board will approve this resolution. That is not what I'm recommending, and they have been reasonable to work with.
Pledge the board. Chairman. Do I hear a second?
Second.
It is time sensitive.
Time sensitive.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, vote on the motion. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, like sign. There are none. That passes unanimously. Counselor, is there need for an executive session?
There is, Mr. Chairman.
We do.
No.
I don't see it.
We got you got your item.
Yes, you're right. My item, it turns out, is here on the 24th, and this item is in reference to the EPD, the Grand Cascade situation. They had written to the Georgia EPD and got an automated response back from the EPD that Mr. Faulkner of the EPD won't be back into the office until the 28th, which would be today. Would it be possible to postpone our meeting with the commission for a brief period of time to give Mr. Faulkner time to respond? And I said to them that I would make a motion to postpone this, I guess, until September, so the next work session. 9/11.
I don't mind.
I don't know why we wouldn't. Motion and a second. Postpone until 9/11. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, like sign. There are none. That question is unanimous. Is there another item that I'm missing?
Is that it?
Yeah, that's it.
Okay, is there any need for an executive session?
There is.
Well, we've got a bond meeting.
Yeah. Special call.
6 minutes.
You need a 6 minute executive session?
6 minutes is the bond meeting.
Yeah, but.
I can't do that.
Oh, yeah. I thought you were saying you could. Okay, so do we need to recess this for the bond meeting or adjourn this or what?
We probably need to recess because it is out of this meeting that we will go into executive session. So let's go ahead and recess this one until the special call meeting begins at 5, then we'll adjourn that meeting, come back into our work session, and then adjourn into executive.
Is there a motion to recess this meeting to go into the bond meeting?
Salute.
We have a motion to second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, like sign. Brian, was that an aye?
Yeah.
That passes unanimously. Yes. And we are recessed, and at 5 o'clock, we'll start the bond meeting.
We're going to start the bond meeting in this room. Okay.
I interpret that differently. Anyway, so that makes a little wrong with it. I was just doing an ending story.
I'm going to bring me was.